Hi, chat. How are you? How are you this evening? Are you having a good day? Did you enjoy the episode?
There was an episode?
I guess. Yeah, did you enjoy Equestria Girls?
Yeah, I did.
It was kind of funny that they started with that.
It was also kind of funny that they actually cut out a whole new world thing, that song.
Yeah, they cut
Strange
a lot.
New World, yeah. Because I was watching, and wait, wasn't there a song here?
Yeah, I thought the same thing.
Is that the one where she's just kind of, like, running around looking pretty lost? And
what are all these weird creatures? What's wrong with my face? What are these things at the ends of my legs?
Why is there vinyl scratch? Why is there the Cutie Mark Crusaders here?
And they cut out the Cutie Mark. They cut out the Cutie Mark Crusader bit in the library. And
yeah, they cut out everything library. I mean, everything was just there.
They removed all the fun.
Yeah, pretty much they took all the good parts out of the movie. They took out the Trixie wanting crackers. They wanted the. Like I said, this is a no fun version of Equestria Girls.
Took out the entire song.
It's just, she's going to go through a mirror, they're going to sing a song, she's going to go home. There, Equestria Girls.
Yep. Imagine if they had cut out the cafeteria song. They'd been rioting.
That'd been hilarious.
Hey, everybody. All right, that's all we had. All right. We just wanted to get your attention.
It's just, hey, everybody, and then take those off!
Those look dumb. Aww.
I would like to see them recut it down to like a 30-minute version of the show. That'd be funny.
It'll be good. Just the 22-minute episode of it of just like, oh no, there's the mirror. I'm in the mirror. Oh no, she's mean. All right, I'll leave. Bye.
It would play like a recap, like a cold opener recap.
This week on Equestria Girls.
I'm pregnant. Next time on Equestria Girls.
Flash.
Waka waka.
Oh boy.
Oh my gosh, she's pregnant?
Oh god, no, we're not doing that again.
I don't have the energy for it this week, I'm afraid.
Yeah, strawberry shortcake, okay.
Even though she was on right afterwards.
Yeah.
It's like they are trying to save that show.
The season premiere I think is like next week or something, so we can all watch that.
You like Andrea Libman? Then check her out in this. No, I'm good. I'm pretty
good.
Do you
like Kazumi Evish? Because she's on there too. So is Ashley Ball. Hell, fucking Andrea is on the commercial with basically sounds like Fluttershy.
Please watch our show. I'd like to keep getting paid.
Sure, I get paid from ponies, but not as much as I do from Strawberry Shortcake for some strange reason.
And from what I learned about appearance fees and everything, I'm just like, yeah.
What? Cynicism on the internet?
Dear Princess Celestia, I learned about appearance fees this week and understand why we can't get all the guests.
That's why we go for, like, the secondary guests.
Now I understand. Now I understand why Andrea and Gilda keep getting attached to conventions. Sincerely. Now we know why Peter New is at every convention.
No, actually, I'll talk about it later because it was one of those things where I was told in confidence, but I could probably tell y'all, but probably not to the crowd. So I just remembered because it was a conversation we had about a convention guest and stuff.
Yep. That's conventions guests are interesting because you always think like, oh, they come here because, you know, they want to meet the fans. Yeah.
About that.
Yeah. Well, I mean, there's the fans. That's probably, let's say, 5% of why they come. And probably 90% of it is the big stack of money they receive when they arrive.
Now, like, when I see, like WizardCon and, like, the other, like, sort of, like, fantasy cons that have, like, the most random guests there. Like the WizardCon in Philadelphia, like, a couple years ago, had the girl from the Walking Dead TV show. And if you're wondering which girl, it was the girl zombie from the very, very first scene of the very, very first episode that Rick kills in the cold opener. So that little zombie girl.
What you're talking about.
Yeah, that girl was appearing at WizardCon. You could get her autograph and stuff. So that chick had an appearance fee and everything. So that was kind of Interesting. I mean,
that's how it works. I mean, this is nerd culture in a nutshell. I mean,
it's like every time you see Virgil having a table at a convention, you're just like, "Oh, Virgil!"
I understand that reference.
I remember a picture of him with an empty table, just meet wrestling superstar Virgil. He's just sitting there alone.
I remember back when, and this is ancient ago because I care about wrestling back then, I remember watching NWO during its heyday. We're going to have a new member. It's going to be great. Here comes the winner announcing. And out comes Virgil. I was like, what? What happened?
World order. Now, there's the guys in the black and the white. They're the bad guys. But the guys in the black and the red are kind of good guys. And everyone else is stupid, and we don't care.
And there's the LWO, the Latino World Order, and then NWO 2000, the silver and black.
I didn't even know that. NWO 2000?
Yeah, they were silver and black instead of black and white.
Yeah, because that would have been easy to tell. Is that silver, or is that... No, that's still white. Is it reflective? Is it shining when you suplex them? I can't...
It's the NWO 2000 that had the Bret Hart and stuff like that. Jeff Jarrett, Bret Hart.
Oh, man.
Ah, Jeff Jarrett.
You know, it's not really a New World Order when everyone is part of a New World Order.
Yep.
Yeah.
It's like, wait, are you the New World Order? Because they're technically newer.
So should we get the show started?
Yeah, I guess we should do a show.
Me.
All right. Let me put the cans on.
Do you want to do the intro or?
I'll do the intro because I've got something I want to do this week.
Oh.
I'm suddenly filled with dread.
Put your pants back on.
Every pony, we got something to say.
No.
Oh my God, you're right. All of a sudden there's in the chat. All of a sudden there's just a huge influx of people. I don't know if any of these are actually ready or not.
Or they may be. We may very well be on the front page. Who knows?
Did we retweet?
I tweeted. I don't know if you retweeted.
I don't.
What? That's not what that word means.
Don't be retweeted. Actually, go retweeted.
Go. Oh, jeez.
I got so much editing to do already.
I think that is how you pronounce it. I think it's more accurate, though, if you think about it.
Friggin' just standards of practice this time here.
This is why we're not on regular standard TV. We're on cable TV.
Sure glad that wasn't blood.
Not even cable. We're like Crackle over here.
Scratch, 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 scratch.
That's disgusting. So are we going to start this? What?
Yeah, actually, yeah. I'm trying right now to pull up. I need to pull up the show notes. So.
I did. There wasn't a whole lot of news.
Did you know there's a new episode of Ponies?
Whatever. All
right. If we get bored, we can talk Powerpuff
10
Girls.
10 minutes. Oh shoot! I guess we'll do a show in 10 minutes about MLP.
Whatever.
Oh God! The first email. Oh no! This is gonna be bad.
Yes, it's all your fault.
Poor guy.
Hello, everyone, and welcome. Welcome to Bronyville. This is Bronyville. Let me try that again. How about you say that?
It's Bronyville.
Bronyville. Hello, everyone, and welcome to Bronyville. This is Bronyville, episode 179, recorded on, I'm going to say that's June 13th, 2015. I'm your host, Apple Cider. Our cast of characters are here, like Scope.
It's good to have best friends.
It is, very best friends. We have Five Iron.
Good evening.
Alpha's with us, too.
That is me.
No Sandy at this point. He might show up. And we're doing a special email show for you guys. So.
He might show up or he might be killed by his family. You never know.
Yes, he's having a special dinner tonight. Spending time with families and explaining best friends to them.
Yeah, good luck. All the luck to you, Sandy.
Yeah, exactly.
But it's June 13th, guys. You know what this means.
There's ponies.
We've been waiting a very, very long time for this day. It's, you know, it's been coming. We've been bringing it up, so we might as well go ahead and handle it now. The Steam Summer Sale's going on, and what have you guys been purchasing?
I actually bought Fallout New Vegas because it was $12 after Fallout 4 was announced.
I was thinking about getting New Vegas.
I got the deluxe pack because that was like the game itself was like $6, but the deluxe, all the DLC was $12. So I was like, I'll get this.
Well, they just announced Source 2 as well. I mean, we knew it was coming, but it's like, it's really here now.
Yeah.
Oh, so are you guys going to mod it all Fallout Equestria style and get your little pips up? And
no, I'm not that dumb.
Your blackjacks, and I don't know. That's pretty much every Fallout Equestria I know at this point. Yeah.
I just know that there's some mods, and I think I might download it just to mod the hell out of it. But really, I've been disappointed. There's nothing I've seen that's for sale that I wanted.
I picked up, Stranger's Wrath, the Oddworld game, which I heard really good stuff about. I did some trading with some people and picked up Guacamelee and Mountain, and a few other games, actually, Mass Effect 2, the Republic Commando.
I've heard that game's really good.
It's supposed to be, yeah. It's like based on like the time between Episode 1 and Episode 2 of Star Wars. Unless like a kind of like a squad game, first person shooter. It's supposed to be really good.
I mean, I've been wanting to get Empire at War or whatever it's called. Or I think it was Star Wars Empires at War. That's what it was, right? The RTS one?
Yeah, you might want to check because that might be the one. There was one I looked up where it's like, by the way, the multiplayer is totally offline on this, so you can't play it anymore.
That's a good point. Maybe I'll hold off.
Yeah, there's a big message on the front like, you can't play this online anymore. We shut down the servers, guy.
Enjoy your game.
Yeah, go have fun with that. But yeah, have either of you played or have wrapped your head around the monster game?
Which one?
The game you play to unlock things and pretty much leave your browser open the whole time?
No. What is that? I haven't heard about that.
You haven't seen? Okay, it's you, hey guys, have you seen Cookie Clicker? It's kind of like Cookie Clicker.
Oh God, no! I don't want to touch that.
It's you join in, you go, what the hell is this about? You upgrade things, and then you come back 30 minutes later and go like, oh, I guess I gained some levels. What's the point?
It's like a game you don't play.
It's a game that plays you. I'm pretty certain it's a Bitcoin miner.
Isn't that called a hooker?
Oh.
But yes.
I have a couple games I'm watching, like Max Payne 3. I have it on the Xbox, but I figure I put on this because I like playing Max Payne on the PC more.
Yeah.
And I'm watching Watch Dogs, which is kind of funny. And that's really it.
That reminds me, I still need to buy Shower with Your Dad Simulator.
God.
Come on.
Because it's like Universe Sandbox, but with the shower and dads. So it's...
God.
You play with water instead of gravity and other things. It's pretty neat. I still need to get
I was looking at Valkyria Chronicles and just didn't know. I was like, you know, anime girls with guns seems pretty cool. Then again, I don't know. It wasn't catching me at the moment.
I guess because it just started, but I haven't seen anything that's really tickled my fancy.
No, you're
fine. Didn't they have like... I didn't catch a glimpse because like GTA 5 is still $60, but didn't they have like packs where you got GTA 5 and something else for $60 or something? Or that I can't remember.
They had a few things.
I already have GTA, so I was like, man.
I don't, not on this PC. I wouldn't mind it, but this laptop sucks.
They had some stuff like Witcher 1 and Witcher 2 were like 75% off for a while.
I see a ton of folks playing Witcher 3.
Witcher 3 is supposed to be really, really good. I'm playing Witcher 1 right now. And just, you know, kind of playing around with that, enjoying.
I'm playing Witcher 2 on the Xbox, and I'm like, it hasn't really grabbed me yet. I don't know what it is.
Yeah, I tried that on the PC as well, and I was having a real hard time, so I'm like, well, maybe if I play 1, see if I get invested in the character a bit more, and maybe they'll let me live through 2 a bit longer, because I've picked up and dropped 2 every time. It's like, hey, you want to go through the tutorial again? And it's like, yeah, I guess. I need to remember the systems.
There's a game called Prison Architect? What the hell?
Yes, you build a prison.
Yeah, it's build and manage a maximum security prison. It's only $4.50, and it's an early release. What the hell?
Your early
access.
It's basically
a warning. Like you don't wanna not. You'll be sorry.
Maybe Mortal Kombat. Mortal Kombat X. I was waiting for that one, but that's not on sale either.
City Skylines is only $20.
Skibbity Skylines.
Derp Tittity Tum. Rated PG-13.
Thanks, Rob Schneider.
Borderlands Game of the Year from Borderlands 2, $10.
Anyway, beyond Steam, I guess some pony stuff happened today.
Yes, I heard about that.
So. Yeah, there's no real like pony news because everyone's more interested in the actual episode that actually happened.
Everyone's broken from the episode, you mean?
Yeah.
Yes, well, the fandom is currently a burning tire fire, you know. Nothing remains.
No, there's plenty of remains.
No, it's over.
Unfortunately, it's still around.
Oh, okay.
A smidge survived, and then it's like Cell from DBZ. If like one microbe of him survives, he just becomes whole again.
So shall we go ahead and move forward, talk about news, and get towards this crazy 100th episode we've just bathed upon?
Yeah.
I say yes.
All right. Well, let's do this. First off, we don't have any sponsors yet. We'll get you one beyond, you know, Nightmare Nights Dallas, which is Sandy's gig down there in Texas come October. So, you know, we'll keep you abreast on what happens there.
Right.
But yeah, Nightmare Nights Dallas. So let's move this forward. Currently, the fandom fire status is the city of Townsville is burning.
Oh, that was so good.
Yes,
God.
It is. Oh, wow. Yeah.
Okay, our fandom is doing good. That fandom is like,
that fandom is Civil War.
There's no way to win. There's just, no. I'm sorry, there's no way to win.
The only winning move is not to play.
Exactly. Yeah.
Now, of course, it's not our fandom, so it's obviously not our problem, ish. But anybody want
like
the one paragraph?
Girls.
Anybody want the one paragraph synopsis of what happened?
Probably should. Yeah, throw it out there.
Those who aren't in the know.
Anybody want to take charge on that one?
Nope, not
yeah,
in the
I'll
slightest.
I'll do it. Okay, so cover. Powerpuff Girls. This was a show that was out several years ago and was awesome. Everyone really liked it, and so had a good long run. Created by Craig McCracken, Hadlorn Faust, Tara Strong on it, you know, all your favorites. So what they did is Cartoon Network decided to reboot it and bring it back, which is like, yay, great news. And when they announced it, they also announced the new cast. So the three girls are not going to have the original voice actors from the original series, including Tara Strong, E.G. Daily, and I cannot remember the third actress's name.
Kathy Cavadini?
Yeah. Mm. So when this came out, Tara Strong tweeted that she was upset that she wasn't even called to audition for it. She didn't know it was happening. They didn't get called. They didn't even bother hitting them up. Turns out that they did bring back Tom Kenny, who you should know is the voice of a lot of characters, including SpongeBob, and Mojo. Yeah, the character from Mojo Jojo. So they brought back a lot of the ancillary characters, but they didn't bring in back the main three girls. So Tara Strong complained about it. Then the other two actresses complained about it. Then Lauren Faust got involved and also was upset about it. Now, they didn't really like damn them, but they're like, hey, you know, we love the original characters. And then Tara Strong decided to make a tweet like asking Cartoon Network to reconsider the casting.
The actual thing about that tweet was originally sent out in March.
Yeah, and that's the kind of thing I think people like messed up.
Yeah, because I thought it was like brand new. Then all of a sudden Sony said in the chat, that's from March. I looked, oh my god, it was.
Yeah, so bad timing on that.
But still they're at fault because when they, because they had like the videos of like the Cartoon Network released the videos of the new girls. And Tara like tweeted like that video and they're going, breaking my heart. Kathy was like the one for Buttercups, like, oh, this hurts or whatever. And E.G. Daily was, yeah, so.
Yeah, so, like, there's a lot of, as they say in the fandom, we'll put hurt over it. And then people started flipping out and taking sides. Like, how dare you say, like, against this new, the new actors. And then other people were saying, like, no, it's not the same. We're going to boycott it because it's not the same. So, yeah, a lot of crazy opinions on it.
A lot of, like, the fan VAs in the Pony fandom were like, Tara, I've lost a lot of respect for you.
Yeah. Because she made all these like negative posts about the new casting and everything.
Yeah.
And everyone's sort of taking their sides on it. Now, is there any... Do you guys want to mention this or how you feel about the situations?
I could give zero fucks!
There's our scope.
Edit that out, yes.
I like the... I think I like the hashtag Rowdy Ruff Boycott.
Didn't like Judacris DM29 put that up or something?
I have no idea about that. Was fantastic.
What was that hashtag Powergate or PowerPuffGate?
Yeah, Puffgate.
Puffgate. I like that. Boy. This is the downside. I mean, I hate this for because like Powerpuff Girls, as I understand, was Craig McCracken's college project. You know, he created back way back in the day, and back then it was called the Whoopass Girls. And I mean, you can find the original out there somewhere, probably on YouTube. But to get on the air, he had to sign the rights over, of course, to the network. And here we are, however many years later, and he doesn't have creative control.
That's business.
That is business.
And he's at Disney now too. So he's got like, I'm sure there's all sorts of non-completing causes and stuff like that. That it's Powerpuff Girls now belongs to Cartoon Network, and now Craig McCracken belongs to Disney more or less. So. Yeah. You're not going to see him come back to headline that show because the content creators now have signed over control of the content to the content providers, which is the way things go.
Yeah. Unfortunately, it will always belong to him, but it doesn't belong to him anymore.
Yeah. Kind of like Lauren Faust and Ponies. That's kind of like this same deal.
Yeah.
Now, I guess as far as I want to say is I think it was kind of like, I'm going to assume that obviously the current characters and Lauren Faust don't want these the current actresses to be out of a job or anything like that. But I also understand their frustration because like it seems kind of like crappy like to not bring them back, but bring in, you know, it does look shitty on the surface.
I was thinking earlier is like Cartoon Network when it launched was just, you know, it's fantastic.
What a cartoon.
Yeah, what has happened? I mean, because, like, Cartoon Network, I mean, I know it's been going downhill for a while now, but, I mean, they just keep getting kicked in the teeth and over because of their own decisions. I mean, apparently Teen Titans Go! Is hated, but Young Justice was pretty well received by most of the critics. I mean, I've watched a lot of reviews on it, but, you know, they canceled it after two seasons, and that was an uproar, and then they made an episode of Teen Titans Go! Again, the hated show where they kind of made fun of the people who wanted the Young Justice because it was a, you know, more serious, you know, DC Universe show. And this is like, do you guys know how this works? I mean, you piss off your fans enough and they're going to stop, you know, quote, buying your product.
Yeah. And they're all just going to switch to Adult Swim.
Yeah.
Oh no, we're going to switch to later in the day.
Well, you know. Yes,
we're going to switch to Aqua Teen Hunger Horse or whatever it's called now.
We're going to go to that show about the talking ass. I don't know.
That's a show. You know what? I'm not surprised.
That's a movie in Idiocracy anyway.
there was a show for the longest time which was about an inspector which was a butt. I don't... It's Adult Swim.
Nasty McGee.
I don't care.
Yes, that's it. That's it, Alpha.
Oh, God, it's so bad.
But yeah, as far as like what this goes, is like, it was unfortunate. I don't begrudge the new characters. I've been disappointed, but, you know, I'm keeping an open mind because it's hopefully it'll be just as good a show that it was back then. You know, it is disappointing, but it is what it is, and so let's roll with it and judge it on its own merits.
Yep.
That's all I can say. And I don't think that any of the people involved with the original series have any ill will towards the people of the new series, honestly.
Yeah, it just sounds like one of those things of like, well, crud. It's the thing I've created, and it's my baby. You know, kind of the reason that Lauren is just like, well, I have to step away from Ponies because it's not my creation anymore. It's Hasbro's creation that I've, you know, infused with my powers. And
yeah,
you know,
that's the name of the game. You give it up. Once you give it to a content provider, you give up your control over it, which is. Goes for really any sort of medium, whether it's music, movies, TV. Once you give it to someone to distribute, they're in control of it, pretty much.
I mean, Hasbro pretty much at this point could shelve Friendship as Magic, make Gen 6, and be like, Twilight Sparkle is now voiced by Jack Black. Hey, guys, what's going on?
I would watch that, I think.
I would, too.
In this discussion, it always reminds me of Todd McFarlane, and whether you like him or hate him, I remember there was... in Spawn's heyday, apparently, I think it was Marvel tried to buy him out. One of the big two, maybe both tried to buy him out, I don't know. And they were going to, you know, absorb Spawn into their universe. And he made, I want to say it was like Spawn number 8 or number 18 or something like that, where he basically made an entire issue explaining why he was not going to sell the rights to spawn to any of the companies, and it basically showed like the big kicker at the end. You know, it's a long time removed, so I don't mind saying it here, but there was a reveal of the whole thing with Superman and Doomsday, and just how everything got so muddled and messed up with Superman over the last 70 years. And that was basically his, you know, big middle finger to both companies, saying, you're never going to own this character, it's always mine. Like, and I think the last splash panel was like, forever and always property of Todd McFarlane or something like that.
Yeah. So, well, that's what Image Comics was that Spawn was on, mm-hmm. was the idea that the content creators were in control of their stuff.
Yep.
And Spawn, how 90s.
Oh, very yeah. Like the most 90s.
Oh, at least you could always go back to watching MTV's The Head.
So, yeah, that's how things are in Townsville. In the Pony fandom...
Pony fandom is happy because we got a new episode.
I guess where's so. The kaboom? There was supposed to be a fandom-shattering kaboom!
I don't know. The last time there was one of these, it was a slow-burning kaboom. We have to be wary.
I was... You know, when they said they were going to have Doctor Who, I thought, okay, it'll be, you know, a wink at the camera and that'll be it. Like, no, this is the freaking Doctor!
I thought it was going to be, you know, it was like that episode of The Simpsons where we basically went from character to character to character. We didn't see him anymore. No, this is like basically Derpy story.
Yeah, Derpy was the main character, which was yeah, awesome.
Derpy and the Doctor.
Yeah, the only thing, so we've done the character to character.
Oh, I guess we should put up the spoiler banner and then just dissect this episode.
Well, let's get through the news first. I think the only thing I'll say is that we've done the slice of life, everybody's episode, so now we're going to have the episode similar to The Simpsons, where someone dies and you have to guess who.
And then your OC gets on the show. And then you lose creative control over said OC and you can't use it on your artwork or your Twitter account anymore, and you have to make up a new OC because that OC now belongs to Hasbro.
Oh, no.
As we discussed with Powerpuff Girls.
Well, if that were the case, then Sims, you couldn't draw Wildfire anymore.
Yeah.
So there might be something because she's technically show staff that she could do something. And some level of deniability. I don't know. All right. Well, let's go ahead and move forward with what we have here. Scope, sir.
Well, because of the 100 episode, Fourth Dimension Entertainment, or 4DE, has announced the pre-order of Doctor Who's plushie. You can get them in two versions. One with wide eyes, there's the second with koi eyes, which are kind of slightly lidded. Like the Twilight with wings open or wings closed. It's the eyes are always open or the eyes are wide open or just slightly open.
So eyes wide open and eyes wide shut. Gotcha.
Yeah. Ugh.
that is a nice looking plush, I will say.
Yeah, if it's ever released.
Hey girl, that's one nice looking plush of yours. Let's see. Let me pull this up so everyone can see. What do we think? I'm thinking koi eye looks pretty good to me.
Yeah.
Though he looks so surprised with the full eye.
Yeah, he's strawberry shortcake and with the full eyes. And the video is black on the stream.
Yeah, what have you done? You did it wrong.
I did it wrong. Oh, I see why it is. Hold on.
You. Good job. Good job, Derpy.
There, I fixed it. Am I better now?
There we go. Yeah,
it is.
It's over. Okay, there we go. Yeah.
Yep, I got it fixed. All right, so there you go. I like the koi eye a little bit myself.
Yeah, I like the koi is like, hey, what's up? And the wide eye is like, who farted?
Who farted?
Did you fart? Wow.
No.
That smells terrible.
This is the quality you come to expect from Bronyville Podcast.
Oh, God, the chat.
Course it does.
That's definitely.
That's pretty good.
Yeah.
That's pretty good. Oh, so good. All right, let's move on to our next one here, which is.
Speaking of episode 100, We Love Fine is running a 25% off site-wide sale for everything Pony.
Yay.
Site-wide, but only on
Pony? Oh my god, no! No, not the chat, damn it!
Okay, I'm not looking at that. I'm not looking at the chat right now. Okay, I guess I got to look at the
joke. Oh no, I know what Jake is coming next. Cool. I know what's coming next there. Come on, Brody, bring put it up. Where is it? I know what picture's coming next. Where is it? Come on. Yeah, I'll see it when it comes up.
All right. Do you just inform me? Okay, so that doesn't look like the right one.
No.
No? Hold on.
Scroll down a little, though. You may find it.
That year's 2020. This doesn't seem right. Oh, it took me to just Equestria Daily itself. That's dumb.
What? No, that's not the link I put on there.
No, it just exploded on me.
Oh, good
there
job.
There you go. There, I'll use that. Yeah, we love Fine Running 100th episode sale. 25% off pony stuff.
Yeah, site-wide.
So you can get figurines, I assume.
There it is. Yeah.
You can get whatever your heart desires, as long as it's pony.
Today only, yep. So.
You got another 2 hours if you're on Eastern.
Get on it. Get on it, people in the podcast. Go take your time machines back. Do your spells.
Speaking of time machines.
Oh, boy.
That said, we could talk about everything this episode. God, there's so much stuff to talk about. Okay.
Yes, that's the picture right there. Yes.
Oh, boy.
I was waiting for that.
It didn't post in it.
Oh.
No, I just clicked the link.
Okay, whatever. I'll leave that. All right, let's move forward. New promo revealed some new and old. This is still loading for some reason. There we go.
I actually have not seen the new promo. What I miss?
Let's just say that there's like 18 seconds in. It's, well, back to where it all began.
A marketing meeting?
Okay, hold on. Do I need to put the spoiler warning up or something? I don't...
I guess. Okay. It's just a shot with Twilight with other ponies that were from the first episode.
Other ponies from the first episode? The very first episode?
You know, the ones who tried to invite her to a party. She's like, I'm too busy.
Hmm.
You know,
oh, wow.
Lemon Drops and... I guess...
Lyra?
Oh, no, that was afterwards. Lyra waved
Moon
at
him. Dancer?
Yeah, Moondancer.
Moondancer. Oh, Moondancer, the lost love of Spike. So, just... he did have a present for her, and then just totally went, forget it, Rarity.
Yeah.
And that Spike, he's got mares all over the place.
Colgate, Minuet, whatever you want to call her.
Yep. All right, let's see. Moving on... Oh boy, the Sonic the Hedgehog Twitter account.
Gotta go fish!
Oh boy.
This Twitter account is actually really good. This guy, whoever's running this Twitter account, understands how ridiculous trying to run the Sonic Twitter account is.
Well, I thought of two people when I saw it. I thought of you and I thought of Anime James.
The thing is, though, that Sonic tweeted the friggin' Twitter Ponies role player. MLP underscore Rainbow. That's a Twitter Ponies role player.
Yeah.
I have to wonder that, did they just message them directly, just out of the blue, or was it a reply?
No. I don't even know.
Because it seems like these would be, like, replies. I don't see the Twitter account going out and particularly attacking, like, Rainbow Dash out of the blue.
Well, it's daily reminder, so I think it may have been just a random tweet.
I'm going to go after Rainbow Dash all of a sudden.
I'm going to go after Twitter Ponies, Rainbow Dash, yeah.
Oh, whatever. At least Rainbow Dash dresses in style. He has to wear all sorts of, like, bandages over his body.
I'm going to see if I can find if there was like an original tweet or something, or is it just them? Continue on.
All right.
That is a thing. That's actually, that Sonic account's actually hilarious.
So I have to ask, I'm not in touch with all this, with the Sonic stuff. Why is there now an official Sonic Twitter?
Maybe because of their whole Sonic and Angry Birds thing.
Like, they made a ton of news recently because they made a Tumblr post for their new, like, Sonic Boom Fire and Ice thing. And one of the hashtags was, we're going to make it good this time. And people were like, why didn't you make it good the first time?
bring your best MS Paint skills with you to Twitter tomorrow. And then everyone's like, ha, Photoshop, talk about Stone Age. We'll allow it. Please buy an MS Paint license for the future.
A lot happened in that last few moments there. Did I hear Sonic Angry Birds?
Yeah.
Okay, I'm
Angry Bird Sonic Dash Epic. That's what it's called.
Okay, I would take your word for it.
That's a well,
because yeah. I really don't want to. I didn't like Star Wars Angry Birds. I know I'm not gonna like this.
I kind of like that.
Well, you have the Sonic one, which is gonna fly straight in, so it's the basic type, and then you have the Tails one that's gonna get more lift, and then you have the red one that's gonna hit harder, and then you have the pink one that's gonna be really annoying and carry a hammer, and then you have the purple one that's gonna go fishing, and then you have the robot one that everyone forgets but is actually pretty cool, and then all of other Sonic shitty friends.
It's not Sonic, it's my original character, Blonic!
Oh, he's green and has scars on his chest. No, actually, that's an original character from the comics. God damn it!
And I'm not Tails, I'm my original character, Blaze.
I'm the original character blazing it. Ugh.
I'm not actually... I'm the real Knuckles in the real world.
Alright, well, let's go ahead and move forward. How about we talk about an episode, guys?
Yeah, let's do that. An episode to talk about.
I guess we will. No. Let's not go to femme fiction. That's no. We don't go there. Let's go to.
I think M.A. Larson did though.
He very well did. He probably, very possibly pulled a few ideas, especially the Sweetie Belle moment, which, or the Bon Bon moment.
God, yeah, I know, because I was that like, was... wait, I've read a fan fiction like this where there was like an organization that was like behind the scenes of trying to defeat Nightmare Moon. Like, they were the ones that actually defeated Nightmare Moon.
I think, like, every time for all the cons that M.A. Larson has been to, all the weird, stupid shit he's been asked, he has been keeping track of all of it and decided to use it as some big way to make fun of him, make fun of us.
If there was some stupid way he could just put in everything in an episode, he could use plausible deniability.
Yeah.
That's pretty much what we have here. Plausible deniability, the episode.
All right. Though
hearing Bon Bon and Lyran dialogue still blowing my mind.
Mm. All right, yeah. Let's see this. So that's season 5, episode 9, overall episode number 100. Good job.
We did it, people.
Good job doing that 2.5 years late, guys. Get with the program.
Wait, hold on. I have to point out that a Brony account said he educated himself.
Oh.
Good.
Good.
Continue.
Good for that. Air date is today, June 13, 2015, written by M.A. Larson. Storyboarded by Jason Hoitchern and Katrina Hadley. And featuring characters, background ponies, because good God, there were a few of them. Cranky Doodle and Matilda. Oh God, where do we start?
We start with Cranky Doodle going to complain to Derpy. About the wrong invitations.
Oh man.
Okay, so it's Frankie Doodle Donkey and Matilda are gonna get married, and turns out it's gonna be a day earlier than they previously thought it was. That is the setup for the show.
Tell you what,
they plan on tomorrow, but the invitations to the day, so they had to move everything to the day because of a misprint.
And whose fault was that?
It was Muffin.
It was the Muffin's fault.
Yeah.
I'm just trying to even take in, like, there were so many, like, the correct way to actually approach this episode. What's the feeling of, like, what did you guys think about it, just overall?
I loved it. I really did.
I was like, wait, what? Most of the time.
I was surprising.
I really thought I was going to hate it, and I was very much like what you guys were saying, like, this is so much better than it really should be. Like, even more like what I could have hoped for. Just in, like we said, the Lyra and Bob on back and forth, you know, Doctor Who's. Even the Big Lebowski ponies, they were fantastic.
I actually liked the bickering between Celestia and Luna.
Oh, that was great. That was great.
You did. Next time, you're supposed to bring the gift.
I was like, next time, I'll bring a gift, and you bring yours. Like, fine.
Then still being bitter later in the episode towards each other.
Yeah.
Like, oh, there was so many, like, little things. Like, as I said, the Lyra and Bon Bon part, just the entire... All right. I guess what,
that's
what
we gotta go scene by scene.
Yeah, that's the only way that we can do this. So let me go through this. So
I will say I'm surprised at how much they were able to cram into 22 minutes because they got a lot of content in.
Yeah, it seemed like there's a lot more than 22 minutes worth in this one. Yeah.
It's like the commercial breaks are shorter.
Yeah.
But there were still, it was still 22 minutes, like, on the dot. All right, so let's see. Matilda looks at photographs and the scrapbook mentions everyone is getting dressed outside, getting ready for what looks like a wedding, even though their wedding isn't for the next day. Unfortunately, the misprint in the announcement states that the wedding is supposed to be a day early.
And they can't really change it because the princess is RSVP'd, so...
Matilda runs off to get her wedding planner and move all the preparations to that afternoon while Cranky goes to complain to the misprint pony who happens to be Muffins.
Muffin, yeah.
And offers Muffins.
Yeah, that was awesome. She offered Muffins. That was like the first of many, 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 many fan send-ups right there. Because I think it was really interesting because the first thing she has said since the whole Derpygate thing was Muffins, which is the first thing people thought she ever said, ever. So that was a great little tie-in. So, yeah.
All right, so let's move forward here. You have the intro. Let's see. At the Ponyville Cafe, Derpy has lunch with Dr. Hooves as Twilight dashes by, expresses how she wishes she could go back in time and fix the mess she made. Dr. Hooves makes Derpy into his house, and they go through a prolonged tangent about the wonders of science.
Okay, yeah. The whole thing about, like, do you know anything about time travel and just the look he gave to, like, the camera? that was awesome.
There was, like, my life's work, decades, centuries, really?
See, Derpy reminds me about the wedding. Dr. Hooves remembers that he still needs to get his suit tailored. He goes to Carousel Boutique in search of Rarity, but
are we
going to
talk about, like, are we going to talk about Doctor Who's house, which looks reminiscent of the TARDIS?
Do it. Yeah. Go for it. Stop me at any point. I'm hitting the plot points, but anything from the firework flowers to whatever, go for it.
Okay, so the tube of firework flowers, if you've seen Doctor Who's, the center pillar that's in there, there's all the desk of weird knobs and sounds that he just pulls randomly.
The tenant console, right?
Yes.
Yes.
Of just random junk to pull on. So,
I do have to say,
Scope, and Derpy being adorable.
Scope, you didn't get your wish to hear the TARDIS sound at all.
Yeah, right? if I had heard that, I'd have probably just shut off the TV and went outside.
I was listening for it. I really was. I kept waiting for it to be somewhere. But we did get. Well, we'll get to that.
Yeah. So, had that Derpy in the little Zeppelin above, and there's a really good gif someone has of her like bouncing in the Zeppelin, and then the face of kind of like. Her face kind of dropping a little bit as the Zeppelin's being lowered.
Then Denny Butt did a picture.
Yes.
hearts on the screenshot.
Those Denny Butts, those pictures are great.
Yeah.
All right, so the Doctor then goes to Carousel Boutique in search of Rarity, but she isn't there. He brings his dilemma to DJ Pony. I'll say it like that. Who takes him to the well-dressed Lebowski pony, which I guess we can add inside of there. Isn't it great that just...
The dude.
You know what? I'm trying to realize on this that I wonder if, like, Vinyl Scratch... The question at this point is Vinyl Scratch deaf? Or does she simply just listen to music all the time that she can't hear anyone? Like, she doesn't seem to talk to anyone just because she can't hear anyone.
It's the music. She loves the wubs.
Yeah.
Like she just... I told her she wouldn't talk. Like if she hasn't talked yet, she's not going to talk ever. Her speech is through her music. That's how she expresses herself.
I thought what was going to happen is she was going to open her mouth and hear a gasp and talk, and they were just going to hit the credits. That's what I thought was going to happen. If that happened, I was like, oh, the fandom's going to die.
She just unzips herself and it's Flufflepuff.
I'd have shot myself.
that would have been a laptop throwing moment. Just woo.
I would have cherry pied the wall with the back of my head. That's how bad it was.
That's God. A good
cherry pie. That's amazing.
Don't Scope. Don't kids. Okay, kids don't look at Google search images on what that means. Oh God.
Okay, we're talking about the Lebowski ponies.
Suicide
isn't fun.
No, God.
I apologize.
But what was amazing on that is the dudes, Cutie Mark was the rug. The Walter Pony, his was the briefcase, the drop briefcase, the fake one, which was hilarious too. The one that was full of dirty underwear, if you knew what it was.
And he said that they said that their fourth couldn't make it. I'm pretty sure that was just Jesus Crouton. Dealing with all those 8-year-olds. blind flanks, man.
Oh, man. So let's see. Doing that, Lebowski Pony agrees to tailor Dr. Hoof's suit if he plays as the fourth member of the Lebowski Pony's bowling team. Unsure of the variables involved in the game at first, Dr. Hoof's eventually agrees. Moving on, there's a bugbear.
A panda ring bear, yeah.
Meanwhile, and the fact that it wasn't called Panda Ring, I was sad.
However, well, they weren't going to... It was a panda, and it had rings on his tail. But it was like, I said, get out of here, panda ring bee-bear! And freaking Mike Vogel just retweeted me. I got a lot of faves on that, too, actually.
So let's see. Meanwhile, Twilight assembles her friends outside of various Ponyville ponies. Watch them. Apple Bloom thinks that the monster is about to attack the town, while Octavia Melody bemoans the interference on her music preference, stating that the issue will probably be resolved in maybe about 30 minutes.
Well, that was Sweetie Belle.
That was Sweetie Belle.
30 minutes, yeah. Because still lost. Amazing.
Still a great joke.
Oh, this will be resolved in 30 minutes.
Yeah.
As Matilda... Oh, go ahead.
It's like, maybe it's a friendship problem, and I'll be over in a half an hour or so. It's like, I hope so.
As Matilda comes by looking for Pinkie Pie, a monster does suddenly appear, a ferocious bugbear, and the main six run out to fight it.
A panda, of all things. They're throwing pandas at the main six.
Terrible. With Pinkie Pie preoccupied with the bugbear, Matilda asks Amethyst Star for assistance with the wedding plans. By the way, they were talking of something about that she hadn't done any planning since Twilight showed up. Is there any like past history with Amethyst Star doing stuff?
I don't know, but she was like the Earth leader on the Winter Wrap-Up team.
Okay. All right, that works. Let's see.
Remember, Rarity and Fluttershy were on the team, but they weren't the leaders. Amethyst Star was.
All right, so there is some precedent to that. When Derpy appears to apologize for the invitation mix-up, Matilda cries out that she needs flowers. Unfortunately, Daisy, Lily, Valley, and Rose don't have Matilda's flowers yet.
Nope.
I love the dramatic faints. That was great.
They just faint all the
this
time.
This is awful! The horror! And the twitchy legs. That's great, too.
It totally explains why a stampede of bunnies is enough to do them in.
Yeah.
Let's see.
Canon accepted.
And then it goes into best friends mode.
Oh god, my favorite thing of this episode.
That was a trip.
Okay.
That was
at Town Hall, Lyra Heartstrings and Bon Bon decorate for the ceremony while relishing on their friendship they share. When Lyra mentions the bugbear outside, Bon Bon reveals her true identity as Special Agent Sweetie Drops.
Sweetie Drops.
And that she's been tasked with capturing the bugbear until it escaped from Tartarus.
She had already captured the bugbear. Why? And that's why it wasn't Tartarus, but it tracked her down. It escaped.
Lyra is shocked by this revelation and upset that their friendship was based on a lie. But Bon assures
all those conversations and all the benches they sat on.
The benches. That was great.
But Bon Bon assures her that her friendship is real before leaving to find a crowd to blend into.
That was.
I understood that reference.
That was brilliant too.
Must blend into a crowd.
Just,
I must be a background pony. Hold on.
Okay.
Turns around, backs up, and just fits right in.
So, a couple things about this scene. One, it was Andrea Libman and
Ashley Ball,
and it was just their straight regular voices. I think, like no inflection. I think that's like how they really sound like, if I remember correctly, which I thought was interesting. So there was that. The fact that they called her Lyra, which was a cool, instead of Heartstrings.
Well, her name is Lyra Heartstring, so it was...
Yeah, but that was the thing that sort of, like, took over because of the fandom thing. But the one thing we were talking about, I think even last week we were talking about the whole Sweetie Drops versus Bon Bon thing. Yeah. So when she said her name was Bon Bon, I was like, oh, crap, that's so cool. And then the whole, her real name is Sweetie Drops. It was like, that was a great little play into the whole... That's something like... a crappy fanfic would trying to explain, you know, why there's two different names, you know?
Yeah.
Which I thought was...
Plus why her voice is always different.
Yes, exactly. It was like such a dumb explanation for, you know, just mistakes in the show, you know?
Yeah.
Oh, which God. I loved.
I absolutely love that. Like, Bon Bon, as we've kind of, like, made allusions to in the past when we were making, like, Equestria Daily has Trixie. We have, you know, Lyra and Bon Bon, because when we first made the show, we were like, oh, it's a pair. We're a pair with me and Sandy. So I'm the Bon Bon to his Lyra, which is why I have several Bon Bons. And when that happened, I was like, this is the best. So stupid.
I still loved when she backed up and just to sit in the crowd of background ponies.
Yeah.
Oh, it's so good.
So what's also good is that it was part of, like, a secret organization that had to be, like, you know, taken apart, and Celestia, like, no, like, plausible deniability.
I thought it reminded me of S.H.I.E.L.D. I thought it was the reference there.
And it fit into, like, all, like, the strange, like, quasi-dark fic that people do. Like, like, oh, but wait, there's a secret organization that has to be hidden, and it's below the surface that no pony else can know about it. It's like, it just fits into all that stupid, like, all that, like, Equestria is a harsh, harsh world. We just hide it from everyone.
Yep, it's like Stargate.
Yeah. All right, well, let's see. Moving on, we got Steven Magnet, which, God.
Yeah. The fact they named him Steven Magnet was just beautiful.
Let's make sure that everyone knows that where the Steven Magnet comes from, where that name comes from.
Please do.
The YouTube audio transcriber, wasn't it?
Yes.
Yes.
The YouTube auto transcriber
took
the word sea serpent and spit out Steven Magnet. And that became its name. And now it has become its name.
And they even put that on the toy, didn't they, as well?
Yes,
they did.
That's where it basically became confirmed, was on the toy.
Oh, it just kills me. It's like,
and the fact that Matilda said, like, three times too, just to drive it home.
Yeah,
you're Steven Magnet.
your name is Steven Magnet. But it let's see.
Well, in her case, it was because she's heard the name before but never met him. Ours is just she's just driving it home that his name is actually Steven Magnet.
Let's see. As Dr. Hooves continues to bowl, Derpy appears and asks to use his flameless fireworks in place of flowers for the ceremony. Before Dr. Hooves can warn her about the fireworks' volatility, she flies off. At the spa, Matilda continues to dread about the wedding. She meets Steven Magnet, an old friend of Cranky's, who tells her that during all the adventures together, all Cranky cared about was finding Matilda again.
In a bald spell.
Yes. This calms Matilda down a little, saying what's most important is that she and Cranky are together. However, Steven makes her nervous again when he mentions how important the wedding is to everyone else.
Yeah. And wasn't it, I forget reading this, but I think it was Bithicus Jim or MK Toons who said that Steven Magnet was a gay serpent, and people are like, wah! I remember reading that briefly on Twitter, so it's like, oh great, new stuff to freak out about.
It matters.
Exactly. But it's like, is that confirmed? I remember reading someone like say that back, and I'm like, oh Jesus Christ, people. That's how episodes like this get started.
He has to go to the largest gay bar in the city.
Best friends in Dallas, Texas.
Best friends. Yes,
yeah.
I guess, yeah.
The new location for Nightmare Night Sal, so I said.
Yep.
Oh, boy. Nope. I'm not continuing this joke. Let's move forward. Let's see. The electro cello dubstep time.
Oh, God.
So, this was the point that I went, like, this part of the episode seemed a little bit long. Like, the lead-up to it. Like, I understand that, like, everybody's just like, oh, my God. Octavia and you know, Vital Scratch are live in the same house together, confirmed, you know.
Split down the middle.
They're friends, confirmed, you know, and then they do this kind of crazy dubstep thing. It was an oddly long scene at first.
Yeah. But it worked.
Yeah, let's see.
When I first saw the preview, I didn't actually notice that they jumped over an actual shark plushie.
Yeah, so
I missed that.
When they jump up, look at the road. There's like a shark plus sitting in the middle of the road.
I was wondering if that joke was going to be made this episode, because I think it's just the icing on the cake to everything that's happened already.
I remember Sabrina Alberghetti stating that this episode was going to jump the shark, so...
And it was a literal shark in the road.
So, and I'm okay with that.
Let's see. So, every time they say DJ Pwn 3, I'm just going to put Vinyl Scratch, because it's so much easier to say.
Yep.
Vinyl Scratch returns to her and Octavia Melody's cottage, where Octavia practices music for the ceremony. When Octavia laments how dull traditional wedding music is, Vinyl Scratch enters and provides backup beats for her playing, creating a fresh, invigorating sound. However, Octavia soon realizes that she's going to be late for the wedding, and Vinyl Scratch transports her there on a mobile DJ booth.
Running in those, you know, ponies like, actually... before the show, when they passed by, Featherweight knocked the ink off of him. All I could think of was red versus blue. Oh, she knocked the black right off of him!
That's racist. That's racist.
Oh, yeah, we forgot about that. That entire Featherweight doing the printing and being covered in ink early in the episode.
Yeah. Oh, she knocked the black right off him!
It's like, that's racist.
Along the way, DJ and Octavia pick up numerous other wedding guests, including Matilda. They eventually crash into town, where all the guests are neatly seated.
Oh, not only do they crash on the Twycane.
Yes.
And as they were propelling through the air, Gummy had a thought.
Oh my god.
Was the Gummy introspective. That was...
And then there was also the picture I just posted in the chat.
We had a conversation.
I thought I saw that.
Yeah.
So on the Gummy thing, we had a conversation regarding Gummy, and our thoughts were that he really needs to get a little help. he seemed quite,
What is life?
And yes, so explain to everyone what the weirdness was that occurred during that chase.
Well, when it came... right before they hit the Twycane, there was a brief, rapid fire shots of every pony who's on the cart. And in the middle of that, there's the freeze frame from GHX Studios of everyone in the horse head.
So it's like,
is that who they were? It was the DHX crew.
Yeah, because that pink one is Lunchy.
Oh, and I can totally tell that the one in the back with the brown horse mask is Big Jim Miller.
Yeah.
And I assume the one on the left-hand side is probably Jason Thiessen. And yeah, you know, it's all the production staff, of course.
Lunchy was the storyboarder.
Mm-hmm. Oh,
what's her name? Care something? I can't remember. Because she was the one with the storyboarder in this episode.
Ah, so yeah, it was. It's all just all of them just put their pictures in for whatever reason. And God, do I love it every time they put real life stuff in.
It was like the briefest of scenes too. I mean, you watch it, it's like a small flash. The only reason I saw it is because I was just watching because you got Barry Punch on there drunk as a lush with your friggin' keg.
I noticed something was there because the coloring is different. It switches away from that pastel because it's a photograph. And I remember seeing it, it's like, oh, there's something there, but I couldn't catch what it was.
But what I was doing was like going frame by frame to take pictures of the projector, all of a sudden that, and I went past that going, what the frick was that? And then I had to rewind, go back, and going, oh my god, what is this?
Big Jim Miller, explain.
Explain. Then he's like, pretty self-explanatory. Yeah, that's what he said, it's self-explanatory.
We like ponies. We are ponies.
Let's see.
Then it was a sticky on 4chan. Like, this was on live TV. I'm crying.
Let's see. Is there anyone in the group of ponies that are picked up that we want to talk about? Jelly Pony was there.
Yes. Yeah, the Disco Pony, Thunder Lane, the
Button Mash,
Boxy Brown, Raindrops, Berry Punch with her keg. She was the only one smiling too. She was having a ball.
Berry Punch usually has a ball or a keg.
Filthy Rich. The Lotus Sisters, the Spa Twins, Mr. and Mrs. Cake, the babies, Matilda, Cranky jumped out of the way.
And that's where he got his toupee messed up, correct?
Yeah, it was knocked off as it went by.
Oh, darn.
But I loved as the Wubmobile was going through town, and when they had to make a turn, Vinyl just waved her hoof, and Vinyl reached out with her...
Or Octavia.
Octi reached out and grabbed the friggin' lamppost and turned the cart. Then they smashed in the arcade with him. Then Button Mash ended up on the record player.
So now that we are at the actual wedding ceremony, Yeah. Let's see, we have Princess Celestia and Princess Luna silently bickering to each other over wedding gifts.
Yeah, because they forgot it. You left it on the counter?
Which is just great to hear them just be like normal. Just like, oh, you did that. You were supposed to bring it. No, I brought it last time.
Yeah, I brought it to Caden's Shining Armor. You were supposed to bring it this time, remember?
Oh, and Shining Armor crying at the wedding.
Yeah.
That was normally, also great.
It's okay. He does this at weddings, but normally it's when the wedding after the wedding starts.
Was it bad that I thought that and I just thought he's getting flashbacks?
No. Speaking of flashbacks, you see who was sitting in the back row?
Oh, of course.
That was great.
It's a changeling just hanging out. Hey. The
kids were scared to death. He looked over like he looked over, his eyes got wide, then he looked back. It's like, uh-oh. It's like, who invited that guy? It's just a single changeling drone. It wasn't even Chrysalis. It was a single drone.
I was like, hey guys. Because I heard there was cake.
I'm just here for the buffet.
A wedding crasher. Just like, eh. Yeah. Let's see.
God, and earlier with Horse News, the friggin' the Dr. Evil reference to Steven Magnet. It's not different at all, is it, Steve? Behold!
Hey, I am kind of hungry.
It's not different at all, is it, Steve?
Oh, God, I love that. Let's see what we have here. Then Derpy places the flameless fireworks, and Bon Bon announces that the bugbear has been defeated. As the last of the guests arrive, the ceremony begins, and Derpy accidentally locks the main six out of the town hall.
They're running straight to the door. It's like, nope. Bam! Just shuts them out.
Let's see, the stuff that happens...
Well, don't forget, Lyra ate all of Bon Bon's oats.
Yes, but it was okay.
Yeah.
Because now they didn't have to lie to each other anymore.
It's like, hey, it's like, hello.
We really are best friends.
Best friends. Snip, snip.
Hug. Long hug.
Yep.
Best friends.
Are just going to stare at each other and during the wedding.
The most thing that you can say in a children's cartoon show for best friends.
Yep.
There is that club in Dallas. Best friends.
Yep. Scissor time.
All right. Let's see. We have. I don't see it mentioned inside of here. But
snip, snip.
We have, getting a new toupee.
Yeah, from Steven Magnet's mustache.
That's a nice callback.
Very good one. Let's see. Go ahead.
But what's called the mayor's speech at the end was like such a call out.
Every pony has their own story.
It was a very good speech. It was kind of one of those things of like looking over. So I guess I'll explain the situation I saw it in. But it was like looking over a bunch of people and going like, everyone does have their own stories. Sure, some people are very bad in their stories, but we all are part of this weird community, huh? It was a really kind of like neat and touching thing to do on that. So that was kind of like a moment of just like, oh. The motto's coming home. Hooray.
I saw it as like a call to the fandom.
Yeah.
It's like, this wouldn't have happened without you guys.
And I still love the fact that Derpy just slammed the door shut in the main six. They're hauling ass to get to the wedding. He's like, oh, bam. All ready, Mayor.
Lock. Yeah. Let's see. As the guests are seated and Steve Magnet helps Cranky with the toupee, Major Mayor begins the proceedings. He speaks about how love has brought not only Cranky and Matilda together, but everyone around them, and everyone is the star of their own story. Everyone has a role to play, from the main characters to the minor ones. The mayor officially weds the two donkeys and they kiss. Dr. Hooves' flameless fireworks light into the hall, which, by the way, we forgot about that. The doctor finally arriving wearing just a scarf.
Alan Z.
And I could just hear Five Iron squealing from North Carolina.
I might have had a moment there.
I looked and said, I was like, really? Did they? Oh, God.
Absolutely.
I was like, well, the scarf is okay. Alan Z, really?
Oh, geez.
In case you missed the joke that they were trying to tell.
Yeah.
Doctor
Who. That's the joke.
He's the doctor. You get it? The only way they could have made it more obvious is at the very end, as the credits were rolling out, you just heard this. Yes. Written by Russell T. Davies.
Oh, God.
Far less people died in this episode than normal.
Yeah, I'm sorry. I'm so sorry.
Oh, I can't remember the guy's name. Stephen Moffat. Written by Stephen Moffat.
Yeah, oh, God. Damn you. If that was a kid, he'd have been crying everywhere.
All right, so let's see. Outside the hall, the main six watch the ceremony through the window. Twilight tells her friends how fortunate they are to live in Ponyville and brings them together for a group hug. Except don't touch Rainbow Dash. She got bit by that bugbear.
Well, that's actually killed the whole thing of the main six not having any lines at all in this episode.
Yeah.
I'm okay with that. It wasn't too bad.
Actually, there was an animation error, though, because they were looking through the window, but Stephen Magnet wasn't there. He should have been, like, staring at the opposite window opposite of the door. Hmm. But he wasn't out there.
Well, if you're being picky, then yeah.
He went to the buffet already.
Yeah, hanging out with the changeling.
Let's see.
Random changeling. All the kids were scared to death of him, too.
Love that. That was so great.
No one else seemed to notice. He was just sitting like, what? Uh-oh.
All right, so let's see. I want to pull some of these choice parts of the episode to read back. What is life? Is it nothing more than a needless search for a cutie mark? And what is a cutie mark but a constant reminder that we're all only one bugbear attack away from oblivion? And what of the poor gator? Flank forever blank, destined to an existential swim down the river of life to an unknowable destiny.
I like
it. That was probably the greatest thing ever in this. So yeah, I'd say this is probably like one of my favorite episodes.
What is life? And oh my God, really?
You know, what we need to do is we now need to get Gummy and the comatose unicorn from Bravest Warriors together, and just have them have an existential off.
Oy. Still, it's like, what is life? What the fuck?
Let's see. Here's Major Mayor's. It's remarkable to me. Major Mayor. It's remarkable to me how a story like Cranky's Search for Matilda could fill this room with such a unique collection of ponies. It makes you realize that every pony is the star of their own story, and not just the main characters in our stories that make life so rich. It's every pony. Those who play big parts and those who play small.
There's a changeling. That line. It's...
Yes, those that try and put us into goo pods.
I still love the fact it was just a single drone, too. It was just a single drone.
It's like, hey, what's going on?
It's like, maybe when they invited this guy, he was somebody else.
Somebody's plus one.
Yeah.
Those that play small. If it weren't for every pony in this room and many more who couldn't be here today, Cranky and Matilda's lives wouldn't be as full and vibrant as they are. Which I do have to ask. There was no Discord in this episode, and it just makes me wonder. If Discord is in an episode, I wonder if John DeLancey has something in his claws where if Discord is used, he must be voicing in that episode?
I guess.
Because they can't... It's like they don't want to include him whenever John is not doing a voice.
Well, and plus, maybe in like a next episode, he's like, why wasn't I there? I should have been at that wedding.
Fluttershy, I thought we had this talk.
And then at the end, with the main six, I'm going, who are these ponies? I forgot who these are.
Why am I here? Where's the people I care about?
Yeah, it's like, why are we out here? Everyone I want to see is inside. Why are these six out here? I don't want to see these.
And then what he could do, oh God, and then what you could do is you could have a Discord have a scene where he opens up the town hall as if it was like a toy box. Like how the how the plastic toys where it's like, it's a house, and you open it up and everybody has their compartmentalized room.
Yeah.
A play on the toy line. It'd be great. Anyway... Ah, guys, I guess that's episode 100, Slice of Life.
That was an episode.
That was an episode, yes. Right.
And now it's back to mediocrity.
So, is anybody bold enough to say that is their favorite episode?
I gotta say, it's like Possibly, it's
a,
yeah.
I've only watched it one time. Give me a few more. Give me a few more viewings, and I'll see. But I'm right now at this moment, I'm really liking it.
For me, my favorite's still going to be Pinkie Pride, and
which one is that?
It's up there. It's the one with Weird Al.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, the Weak Al one.
Weak Al. Yeah. Good job.
Hi everyone. I can't lift anything.
No, but my other like big fave was the one not too long ago with Apple Bloom and Luna.
Yeah.
Oh, that was a great one.
Yeah.
I love how they drug out that first act so you don't think it's what it was.
Bloom and Gloom by Haber.
Yep. Bloom and Gloom is probably one of my all-time favorites now just because of Luna. And it's sometimes a thing we fear things so much that it feels like we're trapped in a nightmare.
This one is like really, really well written, and I got it. This just shows why M.A. Larson is so awesome and why we all appreciate his work so much.
At first, it was going to be AKR, but then like schedules got mixed up or something, and she had to do Griffinstone while he did Slice of Life. It was originally supposed to be the other way around.
Yeah, but just him and also the entire staff. I mean, because this was definitely, it was obviously a send up to the fandom. You cannot deny it. I mean, it was just going on like, what do you think, bronies? I mean, that was that would like be a bridge too far, but it was done so well and so smart and really funny that it didn't take away from the show itself, you know?
You know what would have been the terrible sarcastic part of me that would have loved it if at the very end the main six just turned to the camera and went, there, you happy? Credits. It's like, whoa!
By the way, Big Jim Miller just posted the who were behind the horse masks.
Oh my, did he actually put names?
Yeah, left to right. The black one is Tim Packford. The brown one is obviously him.
Yes.
The pink one is at lunch yet. The white one is Golden Russet, Jason Thiessen. And the zebra is Ishii.
Cool.
Riddell.
I want them to bring the horse masks everywhere they go now.
I don't know who Tim Packford is, but I guess let me look.
So that was really, really cool. I want to add in just one thing to this. Today we did a viewing party up in San Francisco. We actually rented out No, it was actually fantastic.
Really?
It was.
Oh, okay. Yeah, no. Tim Packford is a storyboard supervisor.
Yeah. We did a viewing event up in San Francisco. We had a bunch of our crew up there, and we watched a bunch of fan-created material. We may have watched things of some degree, including perhaps episode or not. But yeah, it was a fantastic viewing. It was so good to see it all up and having like a big booming sound system, and I mean it was really, really a great time.
I could never do those, to be honest.
You know, just because it was a theater itself, like it made it so that one, you know, you did have the crowd experience, but it wasn't like, it's not so many people that it's like at a convention where it's just like you can't hear it.
In the movie theater, they actually have, like, the sound for it.
Right,
yeah.
Right. So what you ended up getting is you got people, you know, that would laugh at the jokes, but then they were immediately stopped because they're ready for the next joke to come up. So it wasn't something where, you know, somebody's just going, woo, you know, at the screen.
Or,
Yeah, like...
Oh, my God!
Oh, God, this is just like in the episode where they didn't, like, shut it!
Oh, my fanfic is ruined!
Somebody just runs out sobbing, you know. It's like, no. No, Jason, come back. It's okay. you know, it was a really fun time. We had a really great time with it, and then, you know, we did all that. It was part for the Variety Theater, so they that was Fall for Charity, and we'll end up probably doing it again in a few months. Probably with something perhaps Equestria Girls-esque, we'll see. I want to poison them all. So
with the friggin' flash entry of the six-pack. Mm-hmm.
Oh, God. What if I could coordinate it so we watch all three and make it a three view. Oh boy, that'd be ooh. Hmm. I'll have to see.
Calm down.
I know. I'm sorry. I just got so
excited. Calm down.
Okay. You know what calms me down?
What?
Emails calm me down.
Oh, that reminds me. I still need to put into one cool thing because I haven't gotten one yet.
Well, how about we do some emails? You can...
Well, yeah, you go ahead. Sure. I'll try not to laugh at the first one because of who it's from after what happened
last
time.
Tell you what, I'll read all the emails if you find me a one cool thing.
Okay.
All right.
Cool. I want to read the emails.
Okay, would you like to read the emails?
Go. Yeah, I thought we were going to... Okay.
Now, Alpha, tell you what, you are now email reader. I bequeath it upon you.
Thanks for bequeathing it. Okay.
I bequeath thee.
That's continue.
That's not how we word it.
Just keep going.
Hey, he's got a lava lamp. Okay. This first email comes from Sergeant Dave.
Oh no.
Hello, Bronyville crew. Here's a few belated photos from our season 5 opener party up in Minnesota, featuring Easter egg hunts for pony swag prizes, custom made cutie mark cookies, and mini apple pies. Whoa, why is my screen moving? Son of a bitch. with all three different showing the premiere, thanks to the way everyone's schedules worked out, but breaking up was probably good for the limited space in my home. All told, we ended up with 8 kids from the target demographic, plus 14 adults who fall into the college students and or long-suffering parent bracket. It was made of a fun day and a full place. By the way, no drunk 5-year-olds in case you're worried about the Rainbow Dash Jello shots. The adults who came for the late evening showing did decide to also break out an expensive scotch while we indulge in goofy PMVs after the show, though. Glad to have a regular influx of fresh horse once again. Looking forward to the great season and following your on-air shenanigans as we all enjoy the ride. Best, Sergeant Dave. P.S. We handed out some of those MLP dog tags, pony tags, at the door and had stickers and fairly high-quality temporary tattoos inside. My cadence actually lasted more than a week and led to some pretty amusing facial expressions when people saw it. P.P.S. Maybe I should stop encouraging Scope. But if he looks closely at the photo, he might catch a glimpse at the tail end, of an incredibly rare 2-foot-long Nala statuette.
Ah! Hottest thing on 4 legs! HUFL, man! You!
There's no container.
Oh, there it is! I see it! On the top.
I still don't see it.
It's on, like, the second page where they're holding up their the Funko toys. Look at the top
of the
bookcase. Yeah.
Okay.
Then there's that random kid who looks like Spoot. Like, what am I here?
That's pretty cool, though. That's a lot of people.
Truly, truly the gummy of babies.
What is life?
That's cute, though. They had all the kids there and everything. It's nice when your friends nearby.
Yes, this was the Sergeant Dave was the one that we previously made fun of because of the Jello shots with kids,
and because the way it was.
I do recall that.
Oh God, it was.
We love you, Sergeant Dave.
Yeah, I'm sorry when you were the way it was being read, the way it was. Written down and going, oh my god, this is not sounding good at all.
CPS.
Those kids are going to die.
All right, second email?
Second email.
All right. This one comes from Cyan Blackstone, which almost like an oxymoron, but. Stop.
What are you doing?
No, there's someone's cursor is like keeps going over the text and blocking it.
Well. Look at it on your own and your own window.
I am looking at my own window.
That's Scope. Oh. Scope's doing it.
And now Five Iron's doing it. You are all.
I would never. I would never. Sorry.
All right. So Cyan Blackstone says. So God damn it.
Cyan, calm down.
Hold it together.
So as the con season is starting soon, sadly I was unable to make it to Everfree Northwest, but a small local con. But a smaller local con I did make it to. I thought I would ask some convention-related questions. What is the best panel you've ever been to / on, and conversely, what is the worst? And finally, what is your favorite con story? Thanks for the show, and keep it up.
No.
Well, I can answer panel, because I don't go to panels, so that's good.
I don't want to answer this.
All right, well, I'm
going to
answer
this. I don't want to do it.
All right, I'll go first.
I don't want to play anymore.
Give me my favorite con story, though.
Best panel I've ever been on or two, I think, was my at PonyCon panel that we did at PonyCon NYC, where it was a spoof of the At Midnight game show. That was really fun. got a lot of great audience interaction. It was really funny. Just all around good time playing a really dumb game. So a lot of energy, and I'd love to do that one again. So I'll try and put in to try and do it at Nightmare Night Dallas. I hope to do it again at PonyCon. So it's something I'd like to do anytime I go to a con, because it was really, really good. So the worst panel,
everything else.
Yeah.
Careful.
The ping pong panel is.
I think it's just great.
Oh no no no! I know which one. I know it was the roast of MLP. That was the worst at BronyCon.
Good save year. There. Good save.
The roast of MLP that happened at BronyCon 2013 was it, or?
Let us never speak of it again.
Pretty much, it's the panel that got shut down. It was insane. So
okay. Topic covered.
Wow. Yeah. If you want to know more, go back and listen to old Brony Time episodes where we talked about it.
Don't do it. Don't do it. Don't.
Let's see.
Oh, and favorite con story? Okay. This one's quick. Also at that same BronyCon, there was this cosplayer who's in a full Luna fursuit. Really amazing. I don't know if you guys have seen her, but like the mouth moved and she looked great. And I think Fire Iron, we talked about this. There was a little kid who had been like five or something, little boy, who went up to Luna and asked her about, are you really Princess Luna? It's like, are you still angry about Celestia putting on the moon? And like, you're my favorite. And the girl who was dressed as Luna was totally in character, kept it up, and just made that little kid's day. And I think that was the coolest thing I've ever seen at a con.
I do remember that. That was a very cool suit. It was highly advanced, a couple grand, I'm sure.
Oh, God, yeah. So.
Yeah, I can go next, because this will be quick. Panels? I don't go to panels, so it's all good. Unless I'm like backstage or like staring at it for, or I'm bored.
Fine.
Ask your favorite. What? Go ahead.
Favorite con story then?
Oh, my favorite con story is BronyCon July 2012, when I was sitting in the green room with a couple of other security folks. We just talked with Lauren for like an hour and a half. That's where we learned that Scootaloo was actually supposed to be handicapped and never meant to fly, and that her cutie mark is going to be scooter related. Stuff like that.
Darkest Vic. And the other
good con story was actually this previous BronyCon, because I was sitting in the autographs room, and there was a mother and her like her daughter in line to see Tabitha, and all of a sudden I hear, "Is that really Rarity?" It's like, yeah. It's like, wow.
Oh, and then you have Andrea attacking your water bottle.
Oh yeah, well, yeah. Apparently that kept her from going insane during the autographs. At least that's what Karen was telling me. Because if you don't know the story, what happened was I was checking vouchers and badges outside of the autographs room, and I had a Deer Park bottle with me. Well, Andrea walked by, and I warned her because I didn't want her to trip over anything. So every time she walked by afterwards, she would actively go out of her way to kick it or knock it down or whatever. I mean, I had it on top of a chair, and she actually like. Try to knock it off, right?
Like, and then judo kick it or something. Like
she just kind of got up on one leg, sort of just my webcam's off, but she like got up on one leg, like almost like hopping, trying to kick it off my chair. And then I'm sitting there, I hear a thump and look down, bottles tipped over. Look, there's her fiance. He looks down at me that and goes, "That was from Andrea," and he just wanders in, going, "What? Why do you people keep doing this?" And I would make an overreact, like, "Oh no," kind of stuff. Like, why?
What about you, Apple Cider?
Let's see. Best story. I'm trying to think, like, fandom wise. The ping pong actually was a really, really cool panel.
Except the table was terrible.
The table may have been terrible, but it was fun sitting up there and actually like interacting that way. That was really fun.
That kid was really good, actually, at the end.
Yeah, I mean, it was an overall really fun time. Yeah.
And I think the chat's messing up the stream up again.
Oh, no. It might be. Yeah. I'm getting all sorts of warnings about about like my CPU usage on this poor Surface. So, let's see.
You on the Surface again?
Quiet, you.
Throttle you.
Oh, jinx.
Hashtag professionalism.
That's okay, guys. I'll run the entire show on a tablet. It'll be fine.
Yeah.
It's working right now, ish.
It's giving you warnings. That is not working.
Quiet.
It's getting hot in here, so take off all your clothes.
Granny Smith, please go
back. I just opened up my
door. Let's see. Best one I'd probably say is that. Worst one, I'm going to have to actually dip back to my far, far history. Ages back when I tried to do stand-up.
Oh.
I think I'm going to leave it at that. It didn't go well.
Let there be footage. Let there
what
be
about
footage.
No, there is no footage. It is gone. Know of. Like, I'll tell you how bad it was. It was me and two friends trying to do it, and it was like Sunday at like 3 p.m., so it's the most cold time you could possibly do anything like this. And I start my two friends go before me, and the friend directly, like, okay, well, actually, one friend, so it's supposed to be the three of us, so our set's supposed to take, like, roughly, you know, 20 minutes apiece. One of them has to totally leave, so he's not able to attend, so it's only me and the other guy. The other guy spends pretty much the next 20 minutes lambasting the entire community, like, the entire people in the room.
Oh, God. No.
So, by the time I get up there, it's, like, cold and, like, mildly, like, not really hostile, but kind of like, and then I'm up there. I start telling some of my jokes, and the friend who just recently finished up that mildly abrasive set pretty much skewers my joke by telling the punchline like three lines before it's ready.
Oh boy.
And I was like, thanks. I think I'm just going to leave the room now. Like,
we should do a stand-up panel at the next convention.
No,
I think it's something we should bring back.
No, not even a little.
We do not need a pony to the griffin. We're fine.
I thought one of your worst con stories is dealing with those, that guy who was asking the weirdest questions of the CMC actresses.
I may have blocked that completely out of my memory. Like, I'm kind of like, what are you talking about? I'm fine. I'm totally fine. But yeah, it was, you know, and I think my best convention story, of the ones I mean, I've done some really interesting stuff. Like, one of the things I like to do at conventions is drive around and be like some of the guest of honor drivers, and usually end up hearing like a lot of weird stories from people. And like the one time that I drove a bunch of the production staff around, and they mentioned all the like semi-lewd things that they do when they're storyboarding episodes, like let's see how long it takes for them to notice where I've drawn this thing on this pony. You know, is like, I'm like, really, you guys do that? That's hilarious. But as for like just a general thing, you know what, one thing that I did ages back that was one of my favorite convention stories was back at Anthrocon ages ago with one of my old podcasts, and we got like 30 people together.
Anthrocon.
Yeah, 30 people together, and we all walked across the city to Buca di Beppo, and we all had a giant meal of pasta, and it was incredible. It was a great, great time.
Was it when it's still in Philadelphia?
No, it was one of the first years it was in Pittsburgh.
That'd be like 2006 then.
Yeah, sometime around then. So, yeah. Yeah, it was a good time.
Because 2004 was at the Adams mark, and then all of a sudden Adams was like, hey, we're going to be selling us to Target. 2005 was the forgotten one in the Wyndham in Center City, Philadelphia, and then they moved to Pittsburgh.
Yeah, so I was in 2004, I believe. I was at the Philly one for that 1 year. And
the
then
Adams
it was
mark,
one of the
yeah.
That was one of the Pittsburgh ones afterwards. And
it was a freaking rainy weekend that week.
Yeah.
Yeesh.
Well, the one I was on was a sunny one, so it might have been 2 years past. It might have been like 2007.
Like, when I was driving up, it was terribly raining. As like the last day of that Monday was like pouring down rain in Philadelphia.
Anyway, Five Iron, what about you?
I'm not sure what best panel was. I tell you, the most fun I had was at Nightmare Nights.
Well, yeah, I had fun there too.
I had a lot of fun. Worst, I'll simply say when something doesn't go right, and I'll leave it very vague. let's see, favorite con story. When people showed up for panels.
Yeah.
Unless you like host or like you are, you know, the name on the schedule, it you don't realize how frantic it can be. Because like, what if we go there and we plan all this stuff and we do all this all these things and no one walks in the room and
oh, that'd be terrible. Just
that is heart-wrenching.
I've certainly done the like, hey, we're doing a podcasters panel and there's three people in the room and you're like, ah, okay. Yeah.
That reminds me, actually a good con story was at Nightmare Nights when we all showed Fall Papers Hard Eights.
Yeah.
That was my first time there too. He's like, "Oh my god,
we meat killed this poor Brit."
Yeah. Then he gets a Stetson later on that weekend.
Greetings, y'all.
Yeah,
you're almost there.
We were joking around that he's gonna go up and order and just get shot. It's like, we what are you doing here, you Brit? Get out of here.
May I pick up some spotted dick? What did you say? What did you say to me?
Spotted dick? I ain't got the man. My dick's been clean for years. Get out of here, you
And there's the shark that has jumped.
Yeah.
Jeanette, right, what did you say? Did you
Our next email comes
what
from
Cadbury Mike's like Ivan. The bunny?
Hello again, brony villains. It has been quite a while. I hope you've all been well. No. I was listening to the latest episode of Bronyville Podcast 172, and your talk in the episode Tanks for the Memories. There's something you missed that you might find interesting. Throughout the episode, Rainbow Dash goes through the five classic stages of grief: denial, anger, bargaining, to the point where she effectively trying to turn back time, if I could turn, preventing the seasons from progressing, depression, and acceptance. In my opinion, this was the excellent episode. But I can't help think that it would have been more powerful if they would have taken that one extra step, actually coming out and saying, yes, Tank is dead. It's been done before in a little kid's show, and it was a great success.
It made Larson just jump out and go, he's dead! That's it! Nah!
No,
you know what, they just take,
They did that in the one mashup video.
Yeah, the anthologies.
Yeah, the anthologies. That's he's dead, they, get it?
Just, no, have, it's like, it, at the very end, Larson just pops out, he's dead! That's it!
it'd be like the should we really have that? Should we really have like the Mufasa, like just have Rainbow Dash throw Tank off a cliff like Mufasa?
King. Oh, I almost died.
As I watched Tanks for the Memories, I couldn't help but remind me of an episode of Sesame Street that dealt with death and loss. Back in the earlier years of the show, there was a beloved character named Mr. Hooper, a cheerful old man who ran the general store. In 1982, the actor who played Mr. Hooper suddenly died. Instead of just sweeping under the rug, the show's writers made the gutsy move of addressing it directly and making the character Mr. Hooper actually die in the show, causing all the other characters to have to deal with it. It would have been amazing if Animal P was able to take those same steps to directly address with the permanence of death and the pain of real loss. On a side note, the lesson of tough love Fluttershy learned in the Breezies apparently stuck with her, effectively making her seem cold to Rainbow Dash in the later half of this episode. Anyway, keep doing what you're doing, and it's always enjoyable here. Be seeing you, Rex Ivan.
I don't know. I, as much Tank seems like it wouldn't... I almost go like if Tank died, it'd be like, oh, that's kind of sad. But we need something with more permanence. We need to kill Spike.
No one would really notice. That's the problem. You just gotta kill Fluttershy.
How about this? If you were to kill a character, who character? Which character should die?
Oh, are we going
Bleeding Gums Murphy?
Are we going main six or what?
Just universe, like
universe. Diamond Tiara.
Gilda.
Gilda? Hold up! Hold on the goddamn phone here.
Yep, Gilder.
No.
Killer twice.
No.
Gilder.
She's got a redemption story. I'm a sucker for redemption stories.
Even she's better.
No.
That's what makes it that much more tragic. I've been redeemed, crushed by Boulder. Aww.
Nah, in her quest for more bitch, she becomes a hooker in Grand Theft Auto V, and she gets beaten down by Alfred's son in the game.
Oh, God, how do I... even fix this.
Here, let me teach you how to get the money back from the nice griffin.
No.
This took a dark turn.
Our next email comes from Brian.
Thanks, Rex.
Comes from Bryce Stambon. I'm probably butchering your name. Sorry, Bryce.
Here we go.
Hello, my name is Bryce something, and I am known through Colorado as the ultimate Luna fan because of my tattoo and the fact that I am an MMA fighter and a huge collection of Lunar merch, such as the hoodies, leather jackets, t-shirts, plushies, Lunar Guard because of my OC and the fact that I cosplay my OC, which is a Lunar Guard, but here you guys go for proof. Do we dare click the Dropbox
link? Alright, I had... Metroid had...
probably beat you up for that.
No, this guy wins. Yeah, I had to put this all in a Dropbox link because he sent about 8 pictures. Of course,
enable scripts or something here.
Dude, that's an awesome tattoo.
Looking at the stream, the chat's still wonky, but the video is coming through.
Okay, hooray! Let's see. It's gonna take a while. Yeah, he's got a few Luna things.
I think Tetra tried to beat him up.
Yeah, Tetra would lose.
Tetra would lose. One, because Tetra is, 40 pounds wet.
And 3 feet tall.
Yes, and this guy is an MMA fighter with a giant Luna tattoo, which I have to wonder when, you're getting beaten, you got Luna on you, they're just kind of going like, what? And then
it's a good distraction.
You distract them. You go like, best pony, what? Poof, ow.
It's a really nice tattoo.
Bryce, use confusion. It's super effective.
That is really nice looking. I like that.
Yeah.
It's a lot better than a lot of tattoos I've seen.
Yeah.
And his OC is a night guard. Just like
you. Dude, check out the OC. That's awesome.
I'm not a night guard. Shut up.
Here we go. Wimps. He's like the anti-scope.
He is.
Negascope.
He's a Pegasus. I'm a unicorn. I fire photon torpedoes. He flies and poops on everything.
Yes, that's what.
Equally effective.
He dive bombs with poop. that's why the grass is always greener under the Pegasus.
No.
It's not because of the rain.
No, I want to see this guy fight. I really want to see him kick someone's ass.
Yeah, send us some of your MMA fights if there's a video of it. I'd love just to see punch Luna tattoo, punch Luna tattoo.
Wait a minute, don't they have intro music too for MMA stuff?
If what's he needs his I don't know, like when he if you have not
children
out,
of
like,
the
I
night.
I just sent you to the moon, bitch. That's what he's got to say. So.
Does he have a finisher? Can he call his finisher?
No, it's not. I don't think there's a finisher.
When you knock someone out. When you are able to KO somebody, okay.
I don't know anything.
Friendship is magic, and just like what?
That's awesome.
Talking their sponsorships. He's going like, yeah, Luna Best Pony. Friendship is magic. Ooh.
I want to see a high quality version of the tattoo. Is the one we have in the Dropbox is really low res, so hopefully he's got a better shot of it.
Well, we've now asked for it, so there you go.
Yeah,
sure, we'll come
Scope
our
is
way.
Definitely asking for it.
Yeah.
All right, this next email comes from Night Glider. It says, "Dear AC, Sandy, Starry, Five Iron, Alpha, Scope, et al. Long time listener, first time emailer here. I was just wondering something for a few things. I'm catching up on the podcast recently. I noticed your long hiatus in November, December last year. Now, just prior to this, in your episode, you had been mentioning doing another tabletop with Roger Marsh. Just wondering if that's ever going to materialize and if there's a recording of it and if that has yet been uploaded. I always found your tabletop episodes really entertaining and even inspired me to try my hoof at the game itself. Roger may remember me. In fact, I believe he hosted the one I participated in. I was also wondering if there would be still any episodes of Phantom Unlimited thrown in here and there. On your last one, you made a passing mention of the new Sailor Moon, and while AC didn't seem too enthused, he did mention that Starry was something of a fan. Since this Brony is also a Moony from way back, I thought it would be neat to have a FU where Starry and maybe some other Moonies gave opinions on the new show, vis-a-vis the old, etc. Although I know Starry doesn't seem to like being on air so much. Finally, the last couple podcasts I was listening to, 166 and 167, I believe one of y'all, AC, I thought, had mentioned getting out of the CCG and getting rid of their cards. Just wondering if you had any left after BabsCon and if you would still be interested in sending them off. Let me know. Your loyal listener, Night Glider.
I did not get rid of one of them, and I forgot. So if you want, start messaging me. We'll start the bidding at... I don't know. Give me a price.
Shipping.
It's a double row box. It's totally full. It's all the first season stuff and whatever. You can have it.
Bryce has a lot of Luna stuff because I'm looking at his Facebook page.
Yep.
He apparently works at Papa John's too, so I need some pizza.
Oh, yes. Just ship some pizzas across. That'll be good. Send me $100 in pizza vouchers and it's yours.
It's fairly. It's like a UPS job. Let's see here. I think shift leader at the Luna Garden, rig handler at UPS jobs. Okay.
Delicious pizza. Right. Let's see.
Next email?
Well, no. We got the questions. No. Fandom Unlimited. No. I think that's pretty much on hiatus ourselves. It pretty much didn't end up working out the way that me and Sandy kind of hoped, and it was really kind of a fill-in during the hiatus when we didn't have much to talk about. That's why we brought these three goobers on, and it feels like that the show's gotten a lot better. So
the only reason why I'm on is because we stay in the same room in Nightmare Nights.
Well, and also, we're friends. And
oh, hey, this guy's got a freaking bazooka that shoots plushies. Okay, that's actually pretty cool.
Yeah. So,
and scopes on to the next topic.
Yeah,
I'm on the old topic.
Well, and the last one, the tabletop. I've talked to Roger recently. I actually came over last weekend. I'm just really because there's so many of us now. I'm curious. Scope, are you at all interested in tabletop?
It's one of those things where I'm interested, but I'd rather observe than play.
Okay. And then, you know, Alpha and Five Iron have a little bit of difficulty with it just because they have these children things.
Yeah, and I'm not very good at it. I'm a lousy role player. All these MMO games I've played before, and I can't do that. I try, and I'm terrible at it. Because I'm always like, can I do this? And they're like, you're really breaking character when you do that. I'm like, sorry, but I don't know if I can do this.
I'm never comfortable when playing like games like that for some reason. I don't know why.
Yeah, so what we might need to do is we might need to take it back to Sandy and I and get some other friends in and maybe get another cast and crew together. We just haven't had the time on that because, you know, I do want to have it to be some people that are up for, like, actually tabletopping and having some form of a group, but it's so hard with a group, so...
There's a learning curve to it, definitely.
Yeah, so, you know, I think that what we'll do, I think we'll look at it, especially once the hiatus comes around again. And, you know, I know that Roger's still interested in doing stuff or, you know, doing any form of tabletop. But I don't think it's dead just yet. We just have to, we've got so much content coming in at this time that we're just going to keep going about the episodes. And once we hit a kind of a lull, I think we'll start going back to the tabletop well a little bit more. All right, let's move on.
It's only for you, Apple Cider, this next one.
Oh, yay!
Yeah. So this one comes from Light Snow. Hi there, Apple Cider. The email is mostly just for you, but feel free to read it on the air if you wish. Do you wish me to read this on the air?
You may.
Okay, congrats on the new quadcopter. Since it sounds like you're enjoying your new one and may want to expand, I figured I'd offer up a place full of info if you likely need when you're ready to look at higher-end machines. Check it out at helifreak.com. It is a site with all sorts of RC helicopter types, from traditional helis to multi-rotors. It can be fun to play around with the toys, but there's a lot to learn when getting hobby-grade equipment and doing aerial photography. The rabbit hole is deep, and the cost can be steep. Not just for the machines in question, but all for the supporting equipment, too. The folks at Helifreak are great at helping new flyers, but there will likely be few that will inform you that your drone is a misconception based on a bad media hype. Call it what you will, just fly responsibly. Personally, I'm more interested into traditional helicopters. Why? Take a look at the following video and see what they are truly capable in the hands of a pro. That's why. And then there's a YouTube link. Enjoy your flights. Light Snow. P.S. I know, the most unoriginal name ever. LOL.
Light Show's all right. I've definitely seen worse names like that. Also, Hella Freak just sounds great. Man, that girl's a hella freak.
That's a good name. You might be a redneck jokes. Yeah. Redneck vocabulary.
But yeah, that's cool. I'll check that out in a little bit. I haven't taken a look. I've actually, this terrible thing, I haven't taken the drone out of the packaging in like a week or so just because I've been getting stuff packed up. It's actually in a box over there. I've got like 5 Amazon boxes hiding around.
Thanks.
Here. Yeah, you're welcome. I'm keeping you supported there. Yeah.
Keep my paycheck flowing.
Yeah.
I got an Amazon gripe for after the show.
Oh, good. Well, good. Tell it to the customer service desk. Yeah. I guess we're going to data center.
No. He's return center. You can go, you ask him.
If that were the case, I'd be in Kentucky. Email is from China, so that's always good.
Yep, but
it is. This is going to be fun.
Chinese firewalls. Let's talk about it.
Oh, yeah, no, the whole Chinese underground, apparently, we talked about a few weeks ago or something.
Okay.
A while ago.
There's no from on this one. Hello to all the hosts and guests from the now two times bigger and powerful Bronyville podcast. I listened to your last week's episode, and being a Chinese, here's what I think about the news on the Chinese underground fandom. One, it's true that our network is sort of disconnected from the world. There is a huge firewall called GFW, the Great Firewall, the Great F-Word Wall, blocking part of the internet outside China, including Google, EQG, DeviantArt, Twitter, YouTube, weirdly not Tumblr, because political bananas.
Not Tumblr? That's strange.
Yeah, I know, right? But
they
want to
keep their internet clean. Too much drama. We don't want it.
So SJW, what's that?
But I don't want to think there's a difference in the MLP stuff we have seen since China. Since in China, if you want any access to any of it, you need to use a proxy. Please read dramatically. Oh, my wonderful proxy, what shall I do without you?
Oh, no.
Oh, proxy, I have senpai. To say,
wrong country.
Two,
I have to say that I have not seen any underground clop fandom of MLP in China before, and it's definitely not a big part of the Chinese Brony fandom. Among other non-anime cartoons, MLP is fairly popular here. It has its Chinese adaptation for children. I have seen a lot of people on the internet using pony avatars, and I love Chinese bronies, but the fans are almost all individuals. Please forgive my terrible English. I haven't seen any group activities like cons or collabs, except here in meetups in Hong Kong or Taiwan or Moscow. Macau.
Yeah.
I can't remember.
This
guy's English is a lot better than a lot of the people I do see.
Yeah, no kidding.
Especially at work, too. I love getting business emails that are totally incoherent.
I wish to business with you. Would you?
Please pay me. Thanks.
I have bank account. Send the money here.
Please do be paying me.
What do Chinese bronies do? From what I have seen, writing and translating fanfics is the most popular. We also have people drawing arts, doing SFM, translating news from EQD, and sometimes the awesome horse news, which I do, so he's a translator for Horse News. Transporting fandom videos from YouTube to our local video sites through proxies, which I do sometimes, pirating, which I don't, though I haven't found any musicians yet. P.S. I have not seen any clop in the fandom before, but there are some around.
That's three.
Okay, your cursor is right over it, so it's hard to tell. There is clop site. There's clop site in the news. And that club for a ton of cartoons, but it's still surprising to see it has a section for ponies. And almost all the stuff there are from Japan. Japan has a big influence on Chinese cartoon culture.
Oh, they hate the Japanese there, too. God. Yeah.
P.S. That Little Apple song has nothing to do with MLP, and I hate that song. I guess what I'm trying to say is that the Chinese Brony fandom is pretty much a mix of American and Japanese fandoms, but smaller. Or maybe not as small as I thought, since now there is a site for Klopp. Keep up the awesome work. Looking forward to your next episode. P.S. My elder cousin's 6-year-old daughter says Book Princess is best horse.
She lies!
She is right.
No, she isn't!
Shameless plug, my blog, NFE, news from Kequestria, weekly on Sina blog, if you want to learn Mandarin and stuff.
But you didn't leave the link.
Yeah, you didn't put the link.
Where? Yeah, I didn't see a link here.
Maybe someone could Google that. News from Kequestria.
Okay, well, I'll do that later. Because I want to read the Chinese brony stuff.
Well, you can. All right, that takes us to the end of the emails. If you ever want to email across us, we'll do another email show coming up when we have the time and no guests and stuff like that. That's going to be bronyville@gmail.com. You can send those across to. If you like the show, by the way, if you like the stupidity that we put on for you every single week, you can go over to whatever system you're using to pull this down, iTunes, Stitcher. If you're over on Ponyville Live, if you're listening on Ponyville FM, which we love you all, find your way to go and give us a good review someplace. You know, we love putting on the show, and the more that we can fight like on iTunes and make sure that Kevin Smith and, you know, Chelsea Handler and all those Hollywood bigwigs have to fight it out with a My Little Pony podcast, just makes us giggle a little bit more.
Screw you, Chris Jericho!
Yeah, you're wrestling. What you done? Taking steel chairs? We've put out steel chairs to watch a show. So, there. What do you think about that?
Lion Tamer, we got the Manticore Tamer.
Whoa, boom. That shows you. Actually, there was a bit of news this week that we missed, which was there was the picture that went out of what's his name? God, I'm missing it.
Seth Green
posting in front of a dueling Celestia Nightmare Moon standee. He's just like, hey, check me out. And everybody's just
Brony
like,
curious.
Oh God, it's Seth Green.
I'm like, Seth, what are you doing? Seth, stop!
No, don't give in to it.
There is no escape.
There's only Zul. But yeah, there is there's that. And yes, we do take donations. If you have a little bit of bits and you like this show, you can go over to bronyshow.com, bronyvillepodcast.com, which, interesting enough, is where you can find the show notes and all these pretty, pretty links that we have for that I'm showing you right now on the YouTube.
Why would you like this show?
There might be some reason. Supposedly people like and subscribe. Oh, and we've got a YouTube, too, if you want to see all the videos for this. You can go over to the Bronyville YouTube page. Like and subscribe.
Unedited videos, yes, just so you know.
All the worst stuff on there. Just, you know.
Well, this episode, I haven't gone through minicamp that much, so it's pretty well been like the same image for a while.
Yeah, and I've also been putting up the script, so you know it's less of you.
That's fine. It's less of me is great because I've actually dropped a bit more weight. So hey,
yay! You
get it?
You lost like 120 pounds so far.
Yeah, ever since I started this whole journey, I went from 555 to 388.
Congratulations!
Yeah.
That's us.
Yeah. Well, in February when I had the third year, I was 460, but now I'm 388. I've almost lost 100 pounds since February.
Keep going. Good job. That's no simple task.
Well, no. Yeah. After getting your insides rearranged, no, it's no simple task at all.
Well, you know, whole surgeries and all that.
Ah, hell, I haven't pooped in 2 weeks, so hey, there we go.
God.
That's a lie. It's actually been 3 days. So.
Dear
now,
diary.
If I could lose the weight, that'd be good.
I've got a hemorrhoid, too. It's pretty bad.
Hey, how about we talk about one cool thing?
One cool thing.
It is one more. It is one cool thing.
No. No.
I've got photos.
Not cool at all, is it, Steve?
Gross.
Mercy.
So yeah, you can go over to see it on the show notes. One cool thing. We give you a single link of something that we think is awesome that you should go check out. I'm going to have to pause to figure out what my cool thing is because I've been putting emails in the doc and hosting events. You know what? What I'm going to do? I'm going to splurge. I'm going to say you should go over to the Bronies of Northern California and go check them out if you are a Brony of Northern California because we are revamping that group. And if you are a local, we would love to have you back. Or, you know, you can check out your own local group. Go check out a local group, for God's sakes.
Join that bonk. Yeah, that's what you need to do. Go join.
And
bonk.
If you go to that one, make sure you bring a bottle of water
that's what we all need. If every American brought a bottle of water, they drink it. So, so you can go.
Is it me next?
Yep. Yeah. It appears so.
Okay. So, Steam. Do you have Steam? Do you play Steam? Do you like video games?
Do you like video games with George Went?
Here, I knew it was coming.
Do you like eating baked beans when you play video games?
Would you like to see George Wynn in a video game being baked? In a bean eating video game?
Do you play Half-Life 2 with George Wynn?
Okay, so one game, I've been playing a lot of GTA 5 because it's great on the PC. And they just had their new update out where they've been releasing downloadable content and it's been free, which is cool. Probably because they've made more money than God. Yeah, like GTA has free downloadable content. So they've made several updates where they add new vehicles and costumes and missions and stuff like that. And they just released their latest one, the Ill-Gotten Gains update, which adds super expensive vehicles and clothing and accessories and stuff like that to max out your online character as well. So if you have Steam, add me, alpha_brony, so we can play GTA 5, do heist, and raise some hell together. With or without my son. That's so.
Daddy, shoot that one.
Dang it. Every time I see Red, he looks so pissed, but he's always so happy to be petted.
He is. He's also shedding like a monster right now. So.
Well, it is friggin' June. Come on.
Yeah, he's everywhere. He's all over me at this point, and he's just seated beside me.
All right, let's see. Scope.
Ah, this is one I heard on the radio the other day and had to dig it up. Well, what happened was this girl went under, had to go through chemotherapy for a cancer back when she was 13 years old. Well, it's finally remission. However, she wanted to have a baby. So what happened was before she went underwent chemo, she had some of her ovaries, like, frozen, you know, ovary tissue frozen before, so it wouldn't be affected. Well, it was re-implanted, and now she's had a baby.
Wow.
Is it a zombie baby?
No, it's an actual, it's a baby. No, what, like I said, she had some of her ovary tissue frozen before she underwent chemo. It was re-implanted, and she was able to give birth to a healthy baby.
That's pretty cool.
It's apparently the first time it's ever happened. So, huh. And I was, well, it gives hope to those who are going undergoing cancer and want kids because chemo will mess your day up.
Yeah.
But if you before you go through it and the cancer isn't in that area, you can have some stuff like frozen. And then once the cancer is in remission and gone, have it re-implanted. Boom, you can have kids.
That's awesome.
Yeah, apparently she diagnosed with sickle cell anemia at age 5. She underwent chemotherapy in preparation for bone marrow. Beforehand, doctors removed part of her right ovary to freeze for the future. And then, let's see, more than a decade later, they transplanted the tissue back and she started having periods. 2 years later, she became pregnant at age 27.
It was one of the doctors.
Oh, that happy set.
You ruined.
I know.
You're a jackass.
I'm the worst, I know.
Worse than my hemorrhoid, damn.
Alright, Five Iron, if you want to save me from me.
Sure, sure, here we go. Okay, this one requires a Netflix account, an active Netflix account. Bill Nye the Science Guy, the modern-day Mr. Wizard. Season 1 of his show is on Netflix, all 30-some episodes, and it is really good. I've been watching with my daughter, and... Yeah, exactly. We watch it with my kid, and it's so much fun.
I remember watching Bill Nye when he was on Almost Famous or Almost Live, whatever that show out of Seattle, when he was like Speedwalker walking through the Kingdom trying to get the guy who was planted the bomb.
Yes, he has a background in improv as well as a engineering degree from MIT or something like that.
Oh yeah, he's one of the smartest guys in the world. A lot better than Beekman's world, that's for damn sure.
Yeah, that. Don't even mention that. That does not belong in the same category.
I'll see.
I like Beekman's World.
I like Beekman's World too. Do you know how?
Would.
What?
Well, you heard me. It's just Bill Nye is actual science.
Yes.
Exactly.
Beekman's a guy playing Paul Zaloom and a guy in a rat suit.
Still kind of.
But it was funny, and they actually had
it was funny. Yeah. But when it comes to actual science stuff, Bill Nye is obviously.
Yeah, so, well, I mean, he, as you said, he did stand up and he was, a scientist. And so, he pretty much did stand up one night and used really geeky scientific jokes. And the guy said, "Who are you, Bill Nye, the science guy?"
That happened on an episode of Back to the Future, the animated series, when he corrected Doc Brown with Gigawatt and Gigawatt. And he's like, "What are you, Bill Nye, the science guy?"
I did not know that.
Yeah, that is how he got his name, is by doing stand up and.
No, I mean I didn't know it was on Back to the Future animated series.
Well, they referenced that.
Yeah. Because after every episode, it was a live action thing with Doc Brown, basically, and he was Doc Brown's helper.
Oh. Okay.
I didn't know that.
Yeah.
All I remember was from. From Back to the Future Animated was they had the translator, and for whatever reason they were in ancient Rome, and of course the Biff character that's in ancient Rome is like talking in I guess Greek or whatever, and it translates as butthead across across the translator, and my mom came in and saw that and she didn't like that.
It's like how my parents didn't let me watch The Simpsons all the time because of Bart because he was a rebel.
Oh yeah.
Parents and look, are dumb. They stop us from having fun.
You see, when you're really strict about what your kids do and see, they grow up to be like us. So
let them be free-range crazy kids.
Let them watch cartoons.
If you're in Maryland, if you're free-range, you're gonna get if your kids are free-range, you're gonna get arrested.
Yeah, that's
so. So what is it? What you should do is just let your kids do everything, and they become quarterbacks.
No, not.
My dad
is a delicate balance.
It is. It really is. I grew up with some folks, no names here, but his parents were basically pilgrim, like level Puritan, and oh boy, did they let loose once they hit 18. It was like
die of dysentery.
Well, they have
not
that,
yet.
Well, they have that entire like that societal thing where they're just like, okay, here's your chance. Here's your
no. It wasn't that. It was like, hey, guess what? You don't control me anymore. Out the door they went. And it was a swath of destruction across the city.
Yeah.
And to this day, the tales of Jeanette is still heard in this town.
Hezekiah.
Hezekiah, what have you done?
Sowed all the oats.
Whoa!
If you don't
know all those
us.
Oats you've been you've got for a special occasion, I cooked them and ate them. All of them.
And if you don't believe us, what we're saying about like being strict to your kids and they go crazy, look at the Duggars.
All right, and with that,
that is called a clown car.
And that's
get it right.
That's called the end of this show. Thank you very much for joining us on episode 179. Thanks, Scope.
Thanks, Obama.
Yes, him too. Thanks, Five Iron.
LLZ.
Alpha.
Yeah.
Sanders 2016.
And, you know, for all our wonderful fans, however you're listening to this, podcast, iTunes, Stitcher, Ponyville FM, Ponyville Live, Canterlot Radios, wherever we are, thank you all for, you know, listening, you know.
Yep. We're all best friends.
We're best friends with everyone. 95% of everyone.
It's scissor time.
Oh boy. Good
night, everybody.
We'll catch you next week. Next week we're gonna be talking about Princess Spike, so get ready for yourself. It's a Spike-isode.
Squish squish.
Remember, the best episodes are always followed by a Spike episode.
Yep.
Alright, we'll go ahead and catch you next week. Till then, sleep well, every pony.
Bye.
Da.
What do you
hit
want,
that button?
Cat?
Push the button? Click.
This cat's gonna kill me.
Is the button pushed?
Button. Well, I mean, it's like it's still recording and we're still broadcasting, but the show's over.
Man, nothing says a best friend kiss with the other pair of lips. That's for sure.
Oh wow.
Scope, no scope, don't.
Yes, yes, scope, yes.
360, no scope.
Stop Chris, encouraging Chris. Scope.
Just a gentle caress of the lips.
That's what it takes.
Yep.
Am I right, fellas?
Tickle, tickle.
Red is so annoyed with me right now.
I'm pretty sure Bonbon uses that horn quite a bit.
Oh.
Oh, wow. Keeping it classy.
Sit on my face and tell me that you love me. Sit on your face and tell you I love you, too.
God damn it.
Love to hear you oralize. When I'm between your thighs, it blows me away.
What is that from?
It's
Monty Python.
Oh God. Oh, my life is better now.
You're welcome.
Oh.
Why the musical?
Oh God. Okay. I don't even know what's going on.
I don't know. Red's tail looks like he's about to pounce on something. The way it's flicking like that.
He's just pissed.
Oh. What'd you do?
No, I didn't do anything. He's in his play mode now, which means that he brings out his, like, blood talons so he can destroy something. And right now, if I tester him enough, he'll do it on me.
Like, yeah, hey, I see the tail lash. Hey, he's not happy.
Hey, hey, hey.
He's tolerating. Mouth is opening. There you go. Ah, yeah, no. Well, at least he's not, like, oh God! Whack, whack.
Yeah, he's now gnawing on me.
Yeah, I see that.
All right, enough of that, catty. Enough of that, kitty. Get going.
Yeah, that's definitely play mode.
Yeah, it's definitely play mode with a cat that has like 3-inch claws. And shedding like a monster, so I'm gonna have to handle him in a little bit.
Yeah, get out of clippers.
Yeah, well, I need to get the clippers if we can find them. He doesn't like to sit down for them. I also need to get the de-shedding tool out because, good God, he's shedding everywhere right now.
Just
it's summer.
The vacuum cleaner with the hose attachment. There you go.
He doesn't like the vacuum cleaner much.
I wouldn't think so.
Make sure you record that.
Yes, hold him down.
How to basic groom a cat.
Oh, did you see the
throw an egg at him?
The one he released today was ridiculous.
Was it how to dishwasher?
Yes.
I did see that, yes.
Oh, Red actually drew a little blood on me. Yeah.
It makes you a man.
It
does.
It makes you swift as a coursing river.
It's on my knuckle because it's so hard.
Get on my face, I let my lips embrace you.
So yeah, pony episode.
Best friends.
So we're 9 episodes in, so what does that put us? 1/3 done with this season?
26 episodes.
Mm.
When the Gosh, I guess first we are, two yeah. And the last
this
two.
This has been a great season.
1/3 I love it. Done. 1/3 done.
Now it's time for Princess Spike, where everyone starts to bitch at him, including Fancy Pants. He looked pissed in that promo.
I didn't see the promo.
Oh, dude, it was there. It's basically a bunch of ponies running up the stairs to yell at Spike, who's in front of a door. And right at the top, in front of him is Fancy Pants, who's just screaming at him.
Where's my girlfriend?
Oh, my girlfriend's a damn model, spanging everybody, including that damn shining armor. That was a redneck. That wasn't even a British accent. That was a redneck accent.
What the hell's going on here?
This damn spell messed up my damn voice. She left me, but first she put a spell on my throat. Now it sounds like Hazy Turnip Truck. It's a terrible name for a pony, too. Hazy Turnip Truck. How drunk were his parents?
I assume that's the kid friendly version. I wonder what the original version of that name was.
Sister Fucker.
There we go. Thank you, Scope.
Yep.
There you go. Asking you shall receive.
Straight out of Arkansas. That's Virginia, depending on your point of view.
Alabama.
Oh, no. Roll Tide.
Yeah, listen, you know, there's always one place that Alabama can make fun of, and that's called Mississippi.
For my SSISSIPPI. I was actually down in Pearl, Mississippi a couple of years ago, and there was a tornado warning, right? And I know it was bad when I heard folks on the radio start to pray. I'm going, wait, what? Then I go outside, and the entire sky is spinning. That's
terrifying.
Yeah, because there was like one layer of clouds spinning one way, the one in front of it was spinning another way. It was like really creepy. Apparently there were like 7 funnel clouds that none of them hit, though.
All right, so here's the synopsis for next episode, if you want to get ready. It's going to be another Spike Does Something Dumb episode, I'm pretty certain.
Yeah, basically takes over Twilight's duties and starts doing things like as Twilight Sparkle. Basically putting your name on everything.
So basically he's smelling his feet and all that kind of crap again.
Spike is tasked with making sure nothing disturbs Princess Twilight. The power goes to his head and he begins making important decisions in her name with disastrous results.
So the real question is, who wrote it?
The writer is...
I think it's a new one.
Neil Dussault.
Yeah, okay. That's a new writer.
Benefit of the doubt, then.
Maybe this will be the one person who can crack the code on Spike.
The Spike code?
Finally, Kathy gets to do something again.
What's the good Spike episode?
There is none.
Power ponies. That's about it, though.
My Philomena. Okay.
Yeah, Dragon.
It's a Spike episode that he's not really in that much.
The Dragon Quest one is meh.
Dragon Quest is okay. I like it because of the extra dragons, though, more than, you know.
That's because...
It's a Spike episode that he's not in that much. Well, I guess he is.
Well, there's always there was the interaction where Rainbow kicks the shit out of Rarity, too.
I love that.
They're supposed to be ugly. But I'm weird. I like medium-tiered villains, so it's like, give me more Gilda, give me more Garble, give me more... Well, obviously, it sounds like somebody wants her dead.
Yep.
Five Iron wants Gilda dead.
Unapologetically.
She's the worst.
Confirmed.
You're
so much...
To me.
That's okay.
Yeah, that's quite okay. Nothing of value is lost.
All right, guys, I've had a long day. I think I'm going to go ahead and cut it here because, yeah, doing the event today was a ton of fun, but, yeah, also being social for about 5 hours was
I don't want to be social for only 5 hours unless I'm at a convention.
Yeah, it's one of those things. I love talking to people, but when, you know, the conversation drifts into the minutia of different people's headcanons, it's just like,
you had a panel about that.
I was going to say.
I know. Well, we did that. And, you know, but it's fine when it's like, okay, we're going to rotate through everyone's headcanon and listen to interesting things, but it's when one person is kind of set there and going like, and then I think this, and then I think that, is like, woo.
Hey, speaking of the headcanon panel, did you happen to mention the Celestia Chinese food connection?
I think I tried to.
Okay.
I may have.
Chinese food.
You could go check it. It's going to be posted on our...
I'm not going to watch that.
Yeah. So I'll just go ahead and say yes, I totally did, since you'll
Alpha,
never
you didn't know about Madcan about that?
I think Alpha's probably halfway asleep now.
Okay, because I thought I heard him say what, so...
He should know this. I know this. On occasion, Luna and Celestia will say... Screw the kitchen. Let's get some Chinese food.
No, it's just Celestia. I don't care about Luna.
Oh. Oh, okay.
Well, Luna could. I mean, for all you know, she orders Thai food.
But don't backpedal now. You've chosen your side.
Okay, yeah. Well, Celestia's the best because of that booty.
All right. I'm choosing my side. We'll go ahead and catch you guys next week. Stream over.
That's not a side at all.
That's a side. All right. Bye, everyone.
Good night, everybody.
I hate life.